All right, so on the very last session, you guys infiltrated the Hobgoblin's lair to the very expectation of activating the glyph. For some reason, there was no boom, as Benvolio discussed that there would be. Instead, a cloud of smoke, green smoke, came up from the glyph, and it was a terrifying sight as you guys saw hobgoblins running across the bridge, gagging for air, trying to breathe. Their skin was melting off and they died simply there. Everybody else thought there was nothing else to it. It works in your favor. Now would be the best opportune moment to strike. So you guys did strike in the middle, getting the preemptive strike on the hobgoblins, and Kozmot wasn't there at first, and you guys made quick work of every single enemy within the battlefield, honestly. However, as you guys were, you know, on your way to victory, Kozmot appeared with, it seems as though, Hobby's Hellfire Machine that he created and crafted from something that Benvolio stated that they found as a prototype, and this was the one that was stolen. So Kozmot has engaged in battle with Zeno and Wall. However, in the middle of the battle, that's when a bunch of hobgoblins start to rise from the dead. And these were no normal zombies, as they do seem to run a lot faster. And they do bite, and the bite is deadly. It seems as though Wall has succumbed to some of the bites, as he took 1 point of exhaustion from failing the bite. Within the middle of the battle, Vildara did appear in telepathically, use her telekinesis, not telepathically, she used telekinesis to grab Kozmot in the middle of battle between Zeno and question him of where the anchorites are. He told her they were northeast. And she asked Zeno what should she do with him. Zeno didn't say kill him, so he just said you could do whatever. So she threw him halfway across the battlefield, making Zeno's life even harder, and left the parting gift of a fireball, killing a good portion of the zombie hobgoblins. As you guys know, Breakfast is on top of the Hellfire Machine, about to try to jump into the... try to jump into the machine itself to take care of some of the individuals. And it is now going to be you guys' turn. I don't know how you guys want to do initiative in terms of like who's first between the four of you. I'll leave that to you. However, Wall is in serious danger as he's about to die and get bit up. So.
Damn.
There needs to be some priority, you know, to save his life. Up to you guys. However, I will leave that to you. And so we begin the battle once again. What's going on, guys?
Want to go first, Aurelia? You use magic missile to take out some of those hobgoblin zombies?
I've got fizz that can target 5. So, yeah, I'll go ahead and do that. And... do you have any healing for Wool? Perhaps maybe shove a potion in his mouth.
I do, so I'll bring him back up this turn. If you can take out those hobgoblins.
Yeah. Then there's just Descartes to worry about, I think. Alright. Move forward 30 feet. Oh, can I go ahead?
And yeah, move? Sure. So you're going to be going first for every, yeah, sure. You're going to go first. Okay. All right. It is your turn. Yep.
Target all 5. And use fizz. Ooh.
Ooh, roll of damage. Super fucking useful. It doesn't matter because they all just have 1 HP.
Oh yeah.
That was solid. That was a good use of it. And That's not what I foreshadowed it for. But, yes. So you knock out every single undead hobgoblin, which is great because they were going to try to bite the orc, and that would have been nasty. So each and every single one's head come off as you knock every single one out, killing them in the midst. Anything else in your turn?
I think that's all I can do. I can't even move back because I just moved 30 feet. All right. That's the end of my turn.
All right. Who's next?
I guess I'll go next.
Okay. What you doing?
So Zan's going to move over, look at his fallen brother on the ground, and pull out a greater healing potion and pop in his mouth.
All right.
So give yourself 20 HP, Wool.
All right, Wool, you getting back up, man.
That's what's up. Let me add that HP.
You cough up and you see Zeno with his bright eyes looking at you, blinking.
Zeno. Oh, man. What happened?
You're about to become zombie food. But don't worry, we took care of it.
I give Zeno a, pat on the arm. It's like you saved me out there, brother. Appreciate it.
Of course.
What about the enemies?
Well, we still have that cart, and our guy over there, he's still alive, so I'll go take care of him.
What do you think? You want me to help you take out that guy? You want me to help with that cart?
Up to you. I'll leave in your best decision. And Zeno's gonna start heading over there. And that's all Zeno can do first turn.
Alright. Who's next between Matt and Nahum?
You want to go ahead and go, Wool? Because I'm just going to be moving. I'm not in range to do anything else.
Yeah, that's fine. So I'm going to drink a greater healing potion.
Yeah, 22. Okay.
Okay, so I got back 20, that 30.
By the way, he's still at 40.
Yeah, he gave you a greater healing potion.
Oh, my bad. Thanks. All right, okay. And then I'm going to go and follow Zeno.
All right.
Do you have any more rages?
Yes.
Oh, okay, so I guess the next turn you'll do it.
Yeah. I go to Zeno, I say, I think they'll be fine. Since that guy is running, we need to take him out together, brother.
Of course.
I'm not going to let him get away. And I end my turn here. Actually, I could dash. You know what? I'm a dash. And I kind of yell out to that person, "You're not getting away! There's no escape from us! Surrender, and we'll show you mercy!" That's my turn.
Alright.
I went ahead and took care of my movement, so I'm done.
Okay. Alright, so it's now Ace's turn. And Ace is seeing the opportune moment, and he is going to try to strike at the whales. So he is doing a hit shot. And I'm going to say, if you're trying to do a, aimed shot specifically at the whales, in this particular case, to sort of immobilize the machine, I do have, certain calculation. So if you're doing a precise hit shot, that is going to just be a -2 to the attack roll, which Ace is doing right now.
Let's see. Beating my mind.
Yeah. And fucking regular critter. I fumbled. Rolling a one. Yeah, that's not gonna do it. So Ace misses the shot. The first shot, he's gonna shoot again. And he still misses. Okay. So he is going to miss that. And no immobilization for the machine yet. Breakfast is on top. And let's see, it's not its turn yet. But if it's the Hellfire, if it's the Hellfire engine's turn and it moves, he is gonna have to do a I'm gonna say that's gonna be a acrobatics check, just as, you know, for balancing purpose as it's moving. And let's see, so he is going to try to climb on the other side and try to rip the door off, and he is going to give me a strength check on that one. Let's see, this ability check. Okay, so it's not enough. He's still climbing. He's on like the side right around here, and it's still just not enough for him to rip that door open while it's moving. He's going to try again. Let's see. It's an extra attack. So just a heads up, if you guys are trying to do what he's doing, it'll be a strength check, and you could have, you know, you could count it as an extra attack, basically. Oh, he got a 23. So he rips the door off, hanging from the side. And you see Breakfast go inside of the machine. And that's it. Next up is Ella. Ella is going to have her summon. How far can this thing move? I get to get a dash. Okay. So her summon is going to move down next to Grizzly. And Ella is going to try to protect herself from this one. So let me see what she can do here. She is going to just cast Cure Wounds on Grizzly. Let's see. And Grizzly, you have for five HP. So you're at 52. All right, so she does that. And, she's going to end her turn. Wildfire Spirit removed. Next up is Cassandra. Cassandra is going to pop out and try to attack the Hellfire machine with her gauntlets as she punches both gauntlets together and fires off two blasts. So, first one, little Artificer. First blast coming in. Not enough to hit it. Second blast coming in. Still not enough to hit it. So she misses both, rolling a 14 and 12. Unfortunately for her. Next up is Don John Raskins. He looks over to Allura, who's flying in the air. You know, he kind of takes his hat, put it on top of his head, and he says, "Hey, everything going all right over there?"
I think we've got most of them down. There's just a big vehicle that we need to take down.
Oh, most of them, you said? That's my time to shine. All right, then. You see him, he like goes out, takes a slingshot, and tries to aim at the, can he actually reach this thing? Oh God, he's damn well gonna try. All right, so he takes out his slingshot. He's gonna try to aim at the wheels. And let's see if it hits. Oh shit. All right, he got a 9. No, it doesn't hit. So he's like, oh damn, this kind of fit. Oh, he got multi-attack, so he can attack 3 times with it. Dodge on! Stop pulling the dodge on! God damn it. Oh, man. Okay, so... yeah, so... so Don John misses all of his shots. And, he looks at you, Lord. He's like, oh, good luck. Hope you got something to do.
Sincere contribution.
Not problem. And so, it is now Tia's turn. And Tia is going to hop over this and start to make her way down. She's going to pull a dash. Just want to get into line of sight. And I think Eldritch Blast, and she's doing a dash. She can't attack this turn. Eldritch Blast is 120 feet. My God. So she's going to prepare to start striking at this thing on the other side. She's going to have to move up a little bit closer next time, but that is what she's going to do. So it is now the Hellfire Engine's turn. So some of these hobgoblins inside, they're going to try to strike at Breakfast, who is inside now. And let me see. If you guys want to see what's going on inside, let me put a stream in there. You guys should be able to see. Do you guys see inside of here? Should be able to.
Yes.
If you can't Dropbox and stuff.
Yeah, I see it after tapping.
All right, yeah. So you see Breakfast. He looks around and he's like, take this, you sons of bitches. And he starts whacking them. So let's see if he hits. He takes out his Warhammer. And he misses the first. Only a 15. Holy shit. He knocks off the head very clean. Rolling a critical hit. Killing one of the hobgoblins on the spot. And that hobgoblin is dead. And blood and guts is pouring out everywhere. And that is it for his turn. So if you want to just switch back, you just hit the tab button and you'll go to your character. If you're out of there. So he's up there in there. Next up is Kozmat. Well, I'll give you a second. So Kozmat is heated. And Kozmat, he looks at Wall and he takes what Wall says into consideration. And he's like, you can kind of see him like he's getting back up and he's kind of he's scarred from Vildara. You didn't see Vildara, but he's a little bit, you know, you kind of see like he's scruffed up a bit. He's bloodied up right now. And he listens to what you said. And when you said run away, and he looks at you, Wall, and he says,
did you just say run away? Did you think I would run away?
You're not running away. Then what Benvolio? Are you doing?
Benvolio! Where are you, you coward? Come out!
He's yelling, looking around, and you hear a voice that says, I'm here, Kozmat. And you see Benvolio on the other side. And he looks at him. And you see Kozmat. He takes out, you know, he has both his hands stretched out as if he's surveying the battlefield. And he says,
do you see this? Do you see why we were planning on doing the things I wanted to do for our people? You accepted that human's offer, didn't you?
And you see Benvolio and he says, well, it's because of you the goblins died.
No, fool. That was your foolishness that let them die. Because of how weak you were. Look at what these humans have turned our people into.
And he sort of gestures at all the undead zombified hobgoblins that you guys all killed. And he says,
this is why we don't accept offers and deals from humans, elves, dwarves. They only mean to backstab you at the end. Unlike you, coward, I do what I have to do for my people. Working with them should never be an option.
Do you see anything in the midst of that, Wall?
No, I'm just listening.
Benvolio looks down and he says,
Abby, no, you like, you simply just let them die like that. You could have saved them, but instead You simply stripped them away of everything. These humans, they're not like the other ones.
And at this time, you know, he's talking about two different type of, like, factions, it seems as though, from what you could tell, Wall and Grizzly and Zeno from the conversation. And you see, Cosmot points out,
they are all the same. Every single one. You know what Neverwinter did to us. And that is why we're doing what we're doing. I will not run away. I will fight this man and that man over there. Whoever else comes my way. Unlike you, Benvolio, I will die here with my men. You traitorous bastard.
And he is going to get up and run up to you, Wall, as he is furious. And he says to you,
are you doing this for Neverwinter?
No. I'm doing this to protect the innocent lives. There's no point to fight. You shouldn't judge all humans the same.
No point to fight. You saw what we did. Benvolio, we're the only hobgoblins left besides what's in that machine. You think I'm going to just let you simply just talk me out of this? You're a warrior, aren't you?
Yes, but it's not just about being a warrior. Many people have died on both sides. We can put an end to it now.
Then I expect to die with my men. Brace yourself!
And he is that what your men would want? For you to die?
It's not what my men would want. It's a code of honor that we share.
Wool just sighs.
Absolutely. So, he's going to try to shield bash you. And let's see. Yeah, his shield bash is weird. They give him, like, for the hobgoblins, like, it's usually not like a, it's supposed to be athletics and the whatever, basically, based on athletics. His is an actual attack, but he did hit you with it. Give me a strength saving throw. You're not raging, so it's a normal one. Oh, man. Let me see. Yeah. Okay. No. So,
I liked it when it was almost 20.
Oh, because you ate the food, actually. You're good, then.
Hey.
Yeah, you're good. I was going to say, I was like, oh, yeah. No, so, yeah, you're good. You withstand the shield bash. He does hit you for 5 bludgeoning damage, though. And he proceeds to attack you 3 times. And he's going to use a reaction, actually, before he attacks. And he calls out some of the hobgoblins. You see him yelling, and he says,
man, I need one of you now.
And he's going to use his reaction to call one of the other guys. So let's see if he can move here. 1, 2. So you start to see one of the other hobgoblins, and he runs out because breakfast is busy knocking shit out. He comes out from the machine, and where is he? So he comes out. And he is going to use a reaction to take a dash to get next to his companion. And so, Wall, he has one of his hobgoblins next to you. And he is going to not get advantage. But if he does hit you, he needs to be 5 feet next to an ally. That is going to very much hurt. So, no advantage. But he is calling out one of his hobgoblins to give him the martial ability that does extra damage to you if he does hit you. So he goes for 3 strikes, and let's see what it does. So the first one hits you. Let's see. So that is going to be, let me see, 4d6. 21 points of damage.
Yes, sir.
All right, so he hits you again. Let's see. Hold on, let me see. I don't know if he hits you or not. He misses the second. And he does hit you with the third attack. And that is going to be... I think you're out no matter what. 15 plus 10, 25 points of damage. He rolls a 46. Okay.
I have now been KO'd again.
All right, so... He KOs you, and he looks at you, Zeno, and he says,
"What did you fight for?
More fun."
"Do you see this, Benvolio? This is exactly what I'm talking about."
And he is going to use the rest of his movement right there. So he can only move right there. And, that's it. He's going to move right there. And that's the end of his turn. Alora, you're up. Oh, wait. I did not attack with the Hellfire Engine, actually. My bad. That did not, actually. So it's partly immobilized the guy. Breakfast did not attack the main guy. He attacked the crossbolts that you see. So one of the crossbolts, the ballistas, are now disabled. And... the machine can't move because the guy that was firing the engine has ran out next to Kazmat and it is stationary right now. So one of the guys is going to try to shoot you. Let's see what happens. Are you in range of this? Let me see. Oh, he gets to use a cool one. Okay, so... you do take half damage, but let's see what it does. So basically, you start to see this. You start hearing something behind you, Zeno, and you look around and you see the cannon part of the machine starts emitting a green gas and it spills out like acid.
Oh no. I thought it would target me.
Spraying you?
Just farted on me.
Just farted. Yeah, I literally just farted on you. Give me a dexterity saving throw. My god, you guys just fucking pass this shit on your advantage. Unless you roll like double ones or something like that. No, I don't think.
Don't speak into existence.
Almost.
You needed a 15.
Nope. Don't speak into existence.
Oh my god, okay. Yeah. Okay, so you do take half damage still, which is half of like 30. So you take 15. I did not expect you to fail that, but... Alright, so that is... that's all it's going to do on its turn. And let me see... Let's see... And... okay, so Alora, it is now your turn.
Let's see... I think I'm gonna cast... Gonna measure the range once more. Sorry. Okay, I'm a little too far. darn it. Okay. I might make a dash. Because I'm a bit too far for anything right now. Anyone have objection to that?
No, you're good.
All right. I think I'm gonna just go right next to it.
Let me see something. No, you can do that. I was just trying to figure out something because I think what levitate.
Okay. You can only just move levitate 20, right into it.
You can only move 20 feet on your turn, not 60, unless you go down.
Darn it. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll move forward 20 feet and see what I can do over here.
Sure.
All right.
Absolutely. What you doing? You know that this thing is, because you saw it, it is a immune to fire damage. The Hellfire machine. Yeah.
I can't target inside, like, the window slits or anything.
Yeah, because so where breakfast went on, it's over here on this side.
Okay.
Yeah, so unless you get visual, like Cassandra could, and anyone else who could basically measure, you know, who can go inside of there, basically. Yeah, who can see from the left side can see the, yeah.
I don't have very many super long range spells. So, let's see. I will... Darn it. My heal scrolls are not super long range either. Okay. I think the best I can do is magic missile the cart.
Okay.
If that's possible.
Sure. All right. Yeah, absolutely it's possible. And the wheels are immobile now, so you know that it's not moving because it didn't move on its turn. It's kind of stationary. And so that actually means, hold on 1 second. The fire stopped. So there's no fire. Give me a second, actually. Let me, immobilize the fire. So, so maybe you can go. There's no fire. It is immobilized. It can't move.
All right, let me see. I in addition to what I've already done, I can, waste my Misty Step scroll as a bonus action, and then...
Sure.
Cast a spell on the Hobbok Goblin leader. If I'm not going to use it now, I don't know when I'll use it. So maybe I'll do that instead.
Okay, yeah, you do see that he is kind of bloodied up. He does look like he's, looking worse for wear right now. So,
all right.
Go ahead and choose a point. Yep, nice. Teleport. Right there. And let me go ahead and just put you back up. And, nice little misty step there. And anything else? So, yeah, you said you want to cast a spell?
I will, upcast magic missile on him. He's already in front of Xena, so Tasha's mind whip might not do as much. Well, Tasha's mind whip then. All right. Let's do it. All right.
Yeah, what is it? 90 feet, I think? Oh, wait. Are you too far? I think you're far away.
Oh, shoot.
Yeah, it's 90 feet.
Okay. Yeah. I'll give myself that spell scroll back. Or spell
Go ahead. Yeah.
All right. Magic missile. Sorry about that. And I'll upcast it. So it's, let's see. 4 darts.
Okay. Let's go ahead and click that damage and let's see what it does. All right. So 4 times 4, 16 points of damage he takes. So he gets blasted back, falling, almost faltering a bit, but he does, put his sword into the ground, holding on. And where the hell is the... Oh, there it is. I always lose this thing. There we go. Okay. So that's 16 points of damage. All right. Anything else?
I think that's all on my turn.
Okay, Zeno, you are up. Let's go to the next round. All right, you are up. What you gonna do?
All right. Zeno, seeing a wall fall down, he runs 3 acids straight at him without even caring about the damage.
Okay. He is going to use Brace as his reaction this round and try to attack you once. Let's see what he does. And he does hit you for 4 points of damage.
Already half, right?
Yeah, look at the chat.
Oh, okay. Alright. So, Zeno's gonna use Reckless Attack and attack him with both his Great Axe, or Grey One's Great Axe.
Yeah, and as you're attacking him, he says,
"Do you enjoy killing my people? Just for the hell of it?"
Well, you were gonna attack the village, so I kinda have to kill you now. Bye-bye.
I said bye bye. So it's a good thing he used brace because he could parry, but he can't parry now because he already uses a reaction. So he is going to take 15 points of slashing damage. Oof.
You know, I'm going to attack him again.
All right. Oh my god.
That's not a crit.
This is okay.
This is the other crit axe, yeah, I know.
All right. Roll it down. Oh, yeah, I was about to say, I was like, explain the killing blow. All right, so it's for 10 points of damage.
Zenos gonna use his bonus action to drink a health potion, just a regular healer. Potion of healing.
Okay. He says to you,
how much do you value that man's life?
And he looks at Wall.
Well, you know, I don't know him that well, but if he goes down, he'll go down as a warrior. It's what he would have wanted. And Zeno will end his turn there.
As expected.
All right. Wall, give me a death saving throw.
All right.
You healed yourself or Wall? Zeno?
Huh?
Did you heal yourself or Wall?
I healed myself.
Okay. All right. So, yeah. Because healing somebody else takes an action. Right. So, yeah. You do have one failed death saving throw, Wall.
Oh, shit.
But your good old hero, Grizzly, is about to come into action. Grizzly, what you doing? Not sure if you're mute, Matt.
Oh, yeah. So I move around the corner.
All right.
With my bow in hand, and I actually call out to Cosmot. Cosmot, what did Neverwinter do to cause this?
We simply want to live. However, Daggled Never Ember, Hylia is very suspicious of us. I do not know who you are, but I would not trust that man's word.
With that, we're in agreement. Can we not end this without coming to blows?
Unfortunately.
He looks around at the battlefield, at all the dead hobgoblins laying around, and he says, and he looks at Benvolio, and he says to you,
I will not go down a coward like my men. That, the weight upon what happened today, will forever be etched into my memory. I will go down with my men. If you think you are the warrior to take me out, then I welcome it!
Maybe once I was, but not anymore. And Grizzly pulled, you know, kind of clutches Aria's amulet again, and he lets out another healing charge. So, it'll be enough to catch, Wool.
Okay. Solid. Alright, so, yeah, you guys heal for 24 points of damage. Nice. Nay. A strong
heal. Alrighty.
Strong one.
And I guess that doesn't count as an attack, so I can't use my Zephyr strike movement to keep moving after that. So, I guess that's it for me.
Let me see.
All right. I just get up. I'm like, I'm alive. I'm back again. Thank you, whoever healed me.
Yeah, did you see him? I forgot the action. Like, I forgot to say, the healing touch is an action. The area's grace is a reaction. Like, if you want to, you know, basically use it on a fail roll, it's not even a reaction. Like, the area's grace is like, you know, if you do fail a saving throw, you can just use it or whatever.
Yeah, it's kind of like lucky.
Yeah, okay. Exactly. In that sense or whatever. But yeah, healing grace is an action.
Exactly. Yeah. So
I should put that in the description too.
No, I figured that was an action. It's just Zephyr's strike specifically. I have to make an attack to keep moving. So
gotcha.
So that's it for me.
Okay. Ace is up, and Ace is going to start running, and he's going to start. He's going to make a dash, and he's going to jump up, make a dash inside. So he's also inside helping breakfast. And he is inside now. And he used that as his bonus action. And he's going to try to take out the, as he takes a dash, he's going to try to take out the guy who's firing all the weapons. He's going to take out his short bow and attack. Okay, he hits him for 8 for the first run, rolling at 25. Let's see. He's critically wounded. And he does the killing blow, sniping the head of the hobgoblin in the back, killing him on the spot. And the machine is now immobilized, not moving or firing anything else. And that is going to be the end of Ace's turn. Next up is Breakfast, who is going to try to kill the very last hobgoblin in there. He takes out his warhammer and he says, "Die, you bastard!" And he does. He missed the first one and he misses the second. Rolling 17 and 18, 11. Okay, next up is Ella. Ella is about to rush out in. She's going to try to attack this hobgoblin. Let's see. Actually, she's going to move like right around here. Attack this hobgoblin next to Wall. Yeah, that's a good line of sight. And she's going to fire off Thorn Whip. Is she within 30 feet? Let me see. Nope. Yeah, she's going to just try to use Scorching Ray, basically, at this point. All right, so 3 Scorching Rays firing up. First one hits for 8 points of damage. Second one critically misses. In the third one, she does 7 points of damage, killing the hobgoblin on the spot. And he is dead. All right. Ella then uses her wildfire spirit to move up. And what's the range on this thing, too? 60 feet. Okay. So. Move next to Grizzly. He's going to try to attack Kazmot. And it misses. All right. Cassandra's up next. And she's going to just make a dash. Because she can't do anything like that. And that's about all she's going to do. And next up is Don John, who is, he's, gonna pop out and, charge in there. And that's about it. Next up is Tia, who's gonna try to fire off a Eldritch Blast. Two Eldritch Blasts. And she does hit Kazmot for 12 points of damage. And she's going to fire off another one. And she misses. And right now, Kazmot is literally on death's door. Blood is rushing out. He is literally about to die right now. The Hellfire Engine is... those guys are, let me see, so these hobgoblins are just going to try to attack, well, there's only one left, he's going to attack Breakfast, and there ain't no way I'm thinking he's getting past a 22 AC, but we'll see. He misses, yep, okay, Breakfast. So,
too strong.
Yeah, Breakfast is,
he ate his brick,
Oh yeah, breakfast and lunch. He is a strong dwarf. Strong dwarf indeed. Incredible shield and everything else that comes with it. So next up is Kozmont, and he's bleeding. And he tries to swing at you, Zeno. And he says,
a warrior dies for his people. Remember that, as you say you kill for fun.
And Zeno, he is going to try to shield bash you.
He does roll with advantage.
I'll use reckless attack. Yeah, yep. He misses. Your AC is 18, right?
Yep.
Yeah, he misses. And so he tries to go for three longsword attacks against you. He does hit you with the first for 2 points of damage. And you can see he's like, it's a pitiful, like, state, like, that he's, like, you can tell he's groggy, he's slow, and he kind of just, like, cuts you a little bit. You take 2 points of damage. He goes for another longsword attack. He hits you again. And this time, you know, he kind of slices you, but it's not really like a deep wound as he hits you for another 3 points of damage. And he's completely out of breath right now. And blood is just pouring out of his mouth. And he goes for one last longsword attack. And this one, actually, he uses the very last hit. He runs up to you. And he cuts you on the side of the rib, but it's just not enough to still do a good amount of damage to you. You do take 7 points of damage. And you can see he's groggy and tired. And you see a bunch of blood just pour out of his mouth as he coughs it up. Alora, you're up. Who wants to do the killing blow?
I feel like you're trying to send us a message. So no one else is left in the. Oh, I don't know that. Okay.
Yeah.
Move forward, Dan. This diagonal move so much. Okay, there we go. I'll move up to the cart.
Okay.
Oops, sorry, that's a measurement. All right, and darn it. Are we able to knock him unconscious, or I guess he's there's not much
not
point
you, but everybody else could if they wanted to.
Oh, okay.
But you know, he wants to die a warrior. He wants to go out with his people. I'll leave that to you guys to decide.
What do y'all think?
Wall is very saddened by these occurrences.
Oh.
I guess Wall's gonna speak up. So Wall's just says, please, that's enough. Your name is Kozmont. There's no need for this anymore. We could start again anew, together. Let us bridge the gap.
You see that he's, like, blood's coming out. You kind of see, like, he stabs his sword into the ground to hold himself up. And he says,
no. Kill me now.
You said you're a warrior, right?
And I will die one. Do it!
Before you die as a warrior, you should learn to live like one. A warrior doesn't choose death, they live until their glory is death.
Dying with honor is part of the code of my people, something you humans can't understand. As I stated, I will not be stained with the memory of such of my people dying in this fight. For my peace, kill me.
Then you should carry their memory, instead of letting it die here as well.
He begins to shake his head.
You don't understand anything.
Zeno, is there no way we can get through to him?
Well, as I said, I'm fighting for fun. And I don't fight to kill. I just fight for the sport, for the fun. We can always just knock him out. Up to you.
I would like that. Kazmat, maybe we can show you a different way. And like, what do you call it? Zeno, you know, kind of reached out his hand. Kazmat, you don't have to do this.
Sir, I was lagging. Give me a persuasion check. Only you. And this one's kind of hard.
No.
It's just not enough to convince him otherwise. As he looks at your hand, and he swats it, and he says,
"Do it now!"
Wall is saddened. Doesn't even say anything.
Grizzly will actually kneel down in front of Kazmat since he's kind of staggered. Look him in the eye. I'll kill you, but answer one question for me first. Deal?
You see blood coming out. He says, he grabs onto like your armor and it's bloodied up and he pulls you closer and he says,
"Fine. What do you want?"
"Is a man named Isaac Hawkins involved with any of the betrayal from Neverwinter with you and your people?"
Eye goes wide. And he says,
"He was. He was the one who vouched for us to be slaughtered."
"I see. Then that's one more sin that he will carry to the grave. Thank you."
And he says to you,
"You look like a warrior who has been through much. If there's anyone to end my life, I want it to be you."
"So be it." Grizzly will draw one of his hand axes and just... Do you want me to actually roll the hit, or otherwise I'll just execute him?
Just execute him.
Yeah, how you do just, it. Just a quick cut with his hand axe to finish him off.
All right. And he drops to the floor. And you see he kind of smiles a little bit. And he starts looking up at the sky. Benvolio walks over very slowly. And he drops down to his knees. And he says,
I wish things could have been different, but I'm sorry."
He begins to, you see Kazmat chuckle as he looks up at the sky and he says,
"This was bound to happen to us. People like us, we're always going to be looked upon as monsters. Farewell, fool."
And he dies, giving his last breath, calling Benvolio a hardened fool. And the battle is now over. What do you guys do?
Zan's gonna check the pockets.
Okay. We should gather the bodies and burn them. Okay. Plus, there's still orcs sleeping on the outside from the wine.
Yeah, they're still out there. I don't know what you guys want to do with those guys, but I'm pretty sure you guys probably want... I don't know if you want to kill them or... up to you guys. Orcs a little bit different than the hobgoblins, especially when it comes to the moral code and stuff. So when they wake up, they're probably just going to straight up attack you guys. So I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, they might do some harm to the village. Maybe we can quietly take care of them.
Yeah, so let me know what you guys want to do, and, you know, we'll just narrate it from there. You know, no need to walk up to them or anything like that.
Basically draws out a giant pillow and starts walking towards them.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Okay. So...
I don't know where they have orifices to breathe. I'm just kidding.
So Ace walks, he looks over, and he's like, is it over? Did we win? What do you guys do? Or say?
They're all dead, if that's what you mean.
So, Phandalin is saved, right? He looks over at Wall and Zeno, and he says, Did I say something wrong?
Wall doesn't really say anything as he looks at the ground.
Yeah, don't look too much into it.
You see, breakfast comes out. Bastards got what they deserve. Now then, let's go around and look for some treasure.
Nice job, breakfast.
I agree, breakfast. We should.
You see Ella, who doesn't say anything, she's kind of just like, she has her arms crossed up against the barracks, and she's just standing there on the side, listening to the conversation of what occurred. Breakfast and Ace, they didn't hear it. They were in the machine, so they didn't hear none of that. Tia walks over to Grizzly, and she looks down and she says,
did we did the right thing, right?
I don't think that's for us to decide. But I think this event was manipulated by larger powers than just these hobgoblins.
I see. So, you're saying that because of a certain group from I heard the conversation, they used us to take care of them.
It seems that way. It seems that Isaac and whatever his greater purpose is, he pushed these hobgoblins here and then used us to kill them.
Why would he do that?
Guess the man's a monster. Why else?
She kind of looks down at the ground and she says,
is that the reason why the dragon's here too? Is it something he did?
Guess we'll have to find out.
I see.
At this moment, how long do you levitate for, Laura? I think you levitate for an hour, right?
Oh, yeah, I just...
Yeah, you 10 minutes. Yeah, 10 minutes. Yeah, you're still levitating in the air.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, you're like old Jean Grey over here. just still levitating. Yeah, and at this moment, you guys see a hobby. He starts to walk out of the part where you guys, like, you know, blasted a hole. And he looks over at the situation. He looks at Grizzly and Tia, but he keeps walking. And he looks at Benvolio. And he says, Sir, it looks like the vehicle was spared. Benvolio looks over at him and he says, it was hobby, but at what cost? Hobby kind of moves over and he's like, you want me to get it ready, sir? he says,
"Sure, Hobby. Sure."
At this point, Hobby looks over at you guys and kind of bows and he says,
"Thank you guys for what you did today. I'm not really sure how I feel about it myself, but I'm angry, but there's so many things that led up to this, I can't really pinpoint it on the hobgoblins. But thank you all."
You guys say anything to Hobby?
I feel like perhaps we could use this vehicle for keeping people safe from the dragon, at least. Fireproof.
Hobby says to it's a white dragon.
Yeah. It's opposite of fire. Opposite of fire.
Maybe we could use this vehicle against the dragon.
Hobby turns around and he says,
"Yeah, I gotta repair it and stuff, and I'll take some of the initial upgrades off the thing we saw. But since you guys helped us, I'm pretty sure that we're gonna use this to help with the dragon and whatever else that may come around."
Sounds good. It'll be an interesting addition to the village.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I gotta repair this thing. You guys did do a number on it, but it's still able to move around and stuff. You guys didn't actually disable it or anything, so we can kind of still make use for it. We're probably going to need it in the future, so thanks.
And he goes inside of it. Benvolio looks over at Wall and Zeno, and he says,
"Was he right?" Was he?
Do you guys say anything to him?
It almost seems like, in a way, we've all been used. Someone's agenda.
So probably.
I would say probably.
He says, you start to see him, he looks at his hands and he's like, I'm not sure what happened. That glyph, the scroll, I originally got it from a man. He wore a black and a hat. And he had white eyes. He told me it was a fireball spell, but that doesn't seem to be the case.
He lied to you.
You see,
sounds
Ella,
like necromancy.
You see, Ella, she says, she kind of like, you know, she has her shoulder slumped to the wall. She bounces off of it and like she starts walking and she says,
"You said a man in black. It doesn't really help us too much. Except for one thing, you said he wore a hat and you couldn't see his face."
Benvolio says,
"Yes. He suggested the deal to take care of the orcs and most of the hobgoblins, as it was part of my revenge plan to get back at them. But I'm not really sure how I feel about it. Obviously, what happened wasn't a boom. It was concerning, the least. Seeing them like that in that state, it's a nightmare."
What do you guys think, Zeno? Well,
I mean, it seems like we were being used the entire time. Both sides. Even you, Benvolio, with spell that you were going to set off the glyph warn.
All these events, if I remember correctly, and we did hear that from what Valamin said, the orcs were pushed out by the dragon. Originally, Harbin Wester did something to them, there's family, I don't know what. That's why the orcs wanted to attack. The hobgoblins, however, wanted to attack due to a different reason. With something dealing with Dagger Neverember. But where does this person in black come in is what I'm trying to figure out.
Perhaps as a cultist, maybe. Seems very suspicious.
You think the Cult of the Dragon did this?
Possibly. Can't say for sure.
Hmm. I'll keep that in mind.
At this moment, you guys start to see Don John. He runs up, holding his hat, legs lifted high. Woo-hoo! Damn, y'all kick some ass! I was there too, backing y'all up. Ain't that right, Alora?
That's right, Don John. Thanks for keeping us safe from the back.
You see, he takes his toothpick, he lifts it up, and he puffs his chest out, two hands on his hips. Well, since everything's cleared out, I guess we can search around, see what treasure they left around for us. How's that sound?
Sure. Just be careful about the orcs that are still sleeping outside. Did we already take care of them?
Well, I don't know. Did you guys take care of them?
I don't think so. I think we should go take care of them.
So, are you guys killing them? I mean, I would assume you guys are killing them.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So you guys wrap around and the orcs are still drunk off their asses and you deal a killing blow to every single one as you hear a in succession, one after the other, killing them on the spot. So they're all dead outside. At this time, you start to see John, he rummages around, you know, he goes down to the barracks and the cloud is gone now. Everybody else is starting to, you know, gather around and start to look for whatever they can find and salvage. And after a good around like 30 minutes, everybody does come back to the middle part and you see Don John, he's like carrying, a big treasure chest. It looks like, he wraps it around. And he's like, hey, look what I found. Take a look at the stash they had. And you guys are more than willing to click on it and see what's inside. I will let you guys... So two things. You guys have leveled up to level 6. And you guys can divvy up the treasure.
Hmm.
Yep. So you guys are level 6. So you can go ahead and, if you guys want to look at the treasure chest, go ahead and just double click on it. And it'll show you what's inside. As you guys do see a boots of elven kind, a cloak of protection, some gems, a lesser healing potion, greater, a mirror of the past. This is a magic item. The holder of this mirror can learn something about the history of a specific object or creature by gazing into the mirror and thinking of the target. Instead of the holder's reflection. Yeah, instead of the holder's reflection, the mirror presents scenes from the target's past. Information conveyed is accurate, but it could be random and cryptic and presented in no particular order. Once it's activated, the mirror gives its information for 1 minute or less and then returns to normal, and it can't be used until next dawn. And so I will say if you're using this, you put it up in front of that person. And basically, yeah, you're holding it in front of them and you're basically, I'm going to say when you're using this, you're somewhat incapacitated. Like images are playing in your head and you are basically in this state to where you're learning about the object and like anything else or the person, and you're holding it up to them basically while you're doing it. Just a heads up on that one.
So it's I thought not you like could just a, imagine.
Yeah, so it says, like, once it's activated, the mirror gives its image information for 1 minute or less or whatever. So, yeah, you know, it could vary. You're not incapacitated for 1 minute. It depends on how many images are playing out. And I'll do, like, a secret roll on it to see how much you learn, basically. But I don't know who wants that. So that's whoever can take that. It's up to you guys. You see, you know, you guys see some onyx, a potion of animals friendship, greater healing potion C2. You see a potion of hill giant strength. You see a trident of fish command. Mind you, I didn't just like, I rolled a random generator table from some guy I, you know, like I follow, some DM I follow. And yeah, he came up with that. I was like, a trident of fish command. I don't know who wants that, but if you want to be, you know, Aquaman, sure. And yeah, you see 7,400 gold pieces, 3,000 silver pieces, and 14,000 copper pieces. I will say every single ally here, they only want 500 gold pieces. So if you guys want to split that up.
That's perfectly fine.
Yeah, they all want 500 gold pieces. So if you guys want to split that. So there's, that's Cassandra, Ace. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Valman wants some too. So. Because that information that he brought in disabling, I know he wants some. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that will be. Benvolio doesn't want it. Yeah, 3,500. So the rest of you guys can split. So give me a second. Seven, four, 15. I'll just do it. Don't take anything yet. 3,500.
Like, is Zeno going to become Aquaman? It's a long hair. Well, actually, Wool kind of has long hair.
Okay, so I updated the item pile, so there's 3,950 gold left that you guys can split with and take. So I don't know how you guys want to divvy it up. I'll let you guys do that. But yeah, we could take like 20 minutes to see you the guys to figure out who's taking what and to level up.
I'm guessing for the gems, maybe I should take them so I can exchange them at the miners exchange or no. What do you guys think?
I don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that should be okay.
Yeah, just because I have a relationship, you know, with the owner.
Oh, yeah.
Just a relationship. I didn't mean anything about it. Just, you know, a friendly business, you know.
So
I'll be taking the gems then. Hold on. Makes it easier to look at.
Yep, just take what you want, and yeah. So I would say take the items first, and then you guys can figure out who's taking the gold or whatever.
Makes sense. This is a gem too, yeah. Okay, I took all the gems. Now it's easier to look at. I was going to ask for the Cloak of Protection. Unless you guys want that one.
No, I'm good with all the items. Could take the potion of animal friendship, maybe.
You could take that.
A cute mascot companion. I'm just kidding. No, maybe, I don't know, maybe Grizz or someone could take it.
Well, let me see. Laura, do you have any magic items? I don't think you have. Oh, you have one magic item, just the staff.
I mean, one.
Yeah.
Or staff.
And your AC is 14? Depends. I don't know. So, you know, if you want to take that Cloak of Protection or her.
Oh, well, that's what I'm asking. You know.
Well, I usually don't get hit. Because I stay out of the way. But, you know, just this knock on wood type of thing.
I'll leave it to you guys.
Well, let me ask this. What does everybody want the most? Let me just figure it out that way. Like, we have the boots, we have the cloak, we have the mirror of the past, and we have the trident.
Out of all this, I'm maybe the one who's able to sneakily use the mirror the best. So maybe I could take that.
I wasn't thinking Zeno would take it because it seems a little bit too smart for him. So it doesn't seem like he would be. Yeah.
But I mean, I think Grizz has the most reason to use it, to be honest.
Right. Well, what about you, Matt? Is there anything you want?
Give me a sec. Nothing really stands out as, because the animal friendship doesn't do much for me. Because I'm, you know, ranger stuff. I've already got a bunch of stuff like that. So,
I mean, for me, I'm interested in the potion for greater healing. And then if no one's going to take the Cloak of Protection, then I don't mind taking it.
I mean, if nobody wants the Boots of Elvenkind, I guess I could take those.
I'll take the Giant Strength, Potion of the Old Giant Strength. I'll take that one.
Okay.
No one else wants it.
All right. I'll take the mirror and the animal friendship. Maybe. Unless someone wants to.
Okay. And for the lesser potion, I'll take one of those. I don't know if anyone else wants to take one. Well, lesser potion of greater healing.
I think Wall could use some.
Yeah, if no one wants to take it, then I'll take it. I took the two greater healing ones already.
Oh, okay.
And I forget, how are we doing HP when we level up now?
So it's, if you roll less than the average, you take the average. And just make sure you just roll on here.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Just so I can see it, so.
That's what I thought it was. I've got D&D Beyond open, so I was...
Are you a 1d10 or a 1d8?
I think you're a 1d10, gonna, right? It's going to be different this level. So
wait, why would it be different? You're a ranger, right? Everybody stays the same for the hit die that you get.
I'm going to start multi-classing.
Oh, I took two.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, Naomi, you could take two of the... lesser healing potions. I took two by mistake.
Let me know what you're multi-classing into so I can drag and drop the thing onto you so you can level that up instead.
I was going to see what the D&D Beyond import would pull in. I'll see what happens.
Okay.
Let you know.
Alright, yeah, so I have two then.
Yeah, because I can do that, right? Too. Yeah, that'll just be easier.
Yeah.
If you do the DD import or whatever.
Yeah, that's what I was looking at. And I've got it set to just kind of ignore the weapons and stuff like that since we've got custom stuff there. So I think I've got him done. I'll try importing him now.
I'm not sure if you
so
can.
So, Nahum, let me know if you can. Do you want Aquaman or do you want the Cloak of Protection?
You said you don't have equipment or anything yet, so make sure it's not before you do it. Just give me a second. I'm just gonna make a copy of your character.
Okay.
Because this happened to fucked up Carlos's character before.
Make
a copy. Let me duplicate it. All right, there we go. You're good. So you can go ahead and do whatever you need to do.
Yeah, let me get that the link and then let's see what happens.
Yeah, I don't know if you can do it, but that would. First time I've seen it, but yeah, try it, go for it.
Name, HP, hit die, spell slots, classes, features, spells. Okay,
just took the animal potion.
That's fine, it actually makes sense for you because I think me and Nahum both have like speak with animals anyway and beast sense.
He doesn't have speak with
animals. I don't have that.
He's not a wild, he's not a, a,
nope,
a,
nope. I do not have permission to view the host file system, so you'll have to.
So just send me the link on D&D Beyond, and I'll just put it in right now.
Okay.
Oh yeah, I forgot. Only the Tome Barbarian gets that.
Tome Barbarian.
Well,
there you go. That's the shareable link.
Okay. So I'll just. Name, bio, uncheck bio, uncheck languages, uncheck currency, uncheck equipment, uncheck weapons, uncheck name. Yeah, you don't want to check bio because it'll delete that whole bio.
Exactly. Yeah. So.
Image only HP hit die, spell slots, spells, features, classes. Yeah. I think we're
good. I mean, you can have them both if you want.
Let's see. Yeah.
You sure? You don't want a single one?
Man. It's your boy, Wall.
You want to roll for it, like a 1d2, and like you want to roll it, and I guess one, you get the cloak, two, you get the trident, and I take the other one?
I mean, if you want to do it like that, I don't mind.
Yeah, why not?
All right, well, I guess I'll roll then.
Yeah, you roll. Roll 1d2. I'm fine with either one, although they're both, well, one's more useful, but the other one's like really situational. It's useful too, but really situational.
Yeah.
All right, so Mac, right. Can you roll for HP for me?
I'll take the cloak then.
That's got all the right. The roll already there included. But I can re-roll if you want.
Gotcha. No, okay, you're good then.
Yeah, I'm good, yeah.
Clerics get Thorn Whip?
Nature Domain does.
Oh, okay.
They can take Druid cantrips.
Gotcha. Or
they get their choice of one Druid cantrip.
Gotcha. Yeah, Bless is definitely going to come in handy in that. Yep. So, okay, good.
So I guess we have to split the gold three-way, right?
Yeah. Just take, I guess, like, you know, use a calculator. Just take how much you want.
All right. I mean, we could have Zeno take it to the exchange, convert it to platinum.
Yeah, you could do that.
I carry that much?
Oh, can you carry that much?
Well, let's find out. Hold on. I'll put the 3,000. I'll put the 3,000 gold in first. Hold on. 3,950. Okay.
Almost there. Then the copper. Don't forget the copper.
14, I know, but 000. I know
you're like there.
Well, it's like we may have to build a sledge or something to drag this back to Fandlin, or have multiple of us carry the chest.
Well, Wall can carry some of it, I assume, right?
I don't know.
Funny enough. Not exactly.
Last time we tried to carry a whole bunch of gold with us out of a chest, one of us ended up in prison, the other was incinerated, and just bad things happen when we tend to carry a lot of gold in our pockets.
Alright, I'm gonna be encumbered, but I guess I'll grab the silver.
You're gonna log behind everybody else?
I mean, I can throw away a bunch of these. I mean, I can actually, whatever. I can throw it away, give them away.
But before we load our pockets up, does the chest look like we could rig it up with a couple of poles on either end?
You guys could just give it to the rest of the group if you don't want to take it. If it's too, it's silver. So.
Honestly, I would be okay with that just because we have a lot of money as is already. And I don't spend much anyway.
Okay. Yeah, if you want to give it to Ace, Cassandra, the rest of them, they'll take it.
She gets nothing.
I got plans for money, so I'll take whatever my share is.
I'm joking, by the way. But I guess I look at Laura and Wall and Grizzly and just say, hey, you guys take as much as you can. After that, everyone else can take their share. Whatever they can fill in their pockets.
All right, so Figure it out.
Yeah, I'm done. I can't care anymore.
Is the one they called silver?
Grizzly, you're encumbered, man. You gotta figure something out, Grizzly.
Yeah.
If you want to carry some Alora and or Wall, if you got a little bit more space, go ahead.
Yeah, I can carry like 90 something pounds. And
there's only 14,000 copper left.
0.1 pounds.
That's why I was like, let's have multiple people rig up the chest to carry it, and then we could divvy it up in town.
Let me take 100 copper, see what happens.
Yeah. How much does that weigh?
0.1 pounds per piece? I can only take 950 of this.
Oh, I'm right at the edge. Yeah, I don't think I can take any more. 200. Can I push it? Let's do 50 copper. Oh, that's it. I can't go anymore. Right at the edge.
For some reason, it's not letting me take it.
Won't like go down. You have to like close it and open back up, and you'll see it updated.
Okay, got it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you took it. You're like way over.
Like, you're I actually took too anymore. Many. I took
you
it like
to see...
four times.
Alora, like it's like she's like levitating. She takes out the copper. And she starts to gently float down. Like she is no longer levitating.
So there's 652 pieces of silver that I couldn't carry.
Well, it's like, fuck this. He's going to drop like most of his javelins and say, whoever wants them, it's free season for you.
You see Don John, he scours over. Don't mind if I do. I'll take some of this. And you guys got to figure it out. Because when you're encumbered, like that.
Dude, I actually put all my.
You can barely move.
On. I've got. Has anybody got room for 652 silver? Otherwise, I can pass that off.
You might have to pass that off because I am.
I think I can carry it. Yes.
I can help.
Yeah, 652 silver.
I think so, yes.
Okay.
Because, yeah, your movement speed is reduced by 10, and you make everything at disadvantage right now. Attack rolls, saving throws, all that.
Take it out from your inventory, and I'll add it to my...
Yeah, I've got it out of my inventory. I was seeing how much I needed to remove to not be encumbered.
All right. This is basically 99 gold left in the...
Yeah, you guys want to just give that to the rest of the party? Give that to everybody else?
Yeah. I mean, no problem with that.
Wall still got some.
I'm a little bit, yeah, I'm like throwing more chests. Went from 29 to 2.
Javelins? Oh,
You said we leveled up, right?
Yeah, you guys leveled up. Everybody leveled up to 6.
Okay, enough of that now.
And I think at 6...
Actually, I think I'm overweight. Oh, yeah. Don't worry about
it. No, you are overweight. Get rid of some of that. A little bit. You're like a little bit over, so...
Am I good now?
Yeah, you're good now.
I dropped one javelin. That's fine. Actually, I could just throw this trident too, right? So it's like...
You don't want the trident?
No, I mean, like, I can throw it at enemies and then just pick it back up.
Yes. Yeah, it is a thrown weapon. Yeah, it's a thrown weapon.
But do know that if you are over encumbered, you have disadvantage on saving throws, attack rolls, ability checks, and your speed is reduced by 20.
Oh, yeah.
At the
Actually, he's going to throw his final javelin off.
Okay. He's like, I mean, you can use the gold to buy more, so.
Shit, I might just take the average. I'm not gonna roll this shit. If I get a 1. My hit points.
No. Yeah, no. So if you get a one, you automatically get the average.
Oh.
Yeah. So you might as well roll for it anyway.
Okay.
Get, like, higher than a six. The average of a 1d12 is it seven?
Seven.
Or six?
It's seven.
Yeah, it's seven, right? Yeah.
So, okay. I forgot because, you know, it's been a while since we leveled up. But so we roll. If we get a six roll from my case, I get a six or lower, it becomes a seven.
Correct.
Okay. Yeah, might as well roll then. An eight.
Yes, sir. So you get plus eight.
Let's go.
And then, well, you could do it on the, what's it called, in the level up thing. If you go to features and then level up that barbarian of six. So go to features, barbarian, and then put it to six. And
yeah, that's what I did.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing, see?
Gotcha. And then you may need to...
I got to choose a new beast.
Yeah.
Or, I don't have to choose a new beast. I can choose the same one, but I got to choose something.
Yeah, and I checked. You can't go back and choose the other ones.
I also looked it up myself, so yeah, I have to choose one of the level six.
Yeah.
Bullshit.
Hey, man, they don't want you being too OP.
Man, fuck Jeremy.
Check it.
Yeah, I'm going to choose Tiger.
What does that do again?
So, Tiger gives me proficiency in two skills from the following list. Athletics, Acrobatics, Stealth, and Survival.
Gotcha. Oh, my God. Yep. You get even more with...
And you get a kick-ass theme song.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I got to change my strength. I got to change my strength back down to 16.
Yep.
I'll do that. Okay, there we go.
All right, yeah, just undo the, there you go.
Yeah, I guess I'm not raging either, so I'll get rid of that. I guess I could look it up myself. Where is it? Classes. Some quests.
And Nahum, are you leveling up?
Yeah, I was actually trying to find where it was again.
Go to features.
Features.
Yeah, and you go to Barbarian and change that level 5 to level 6. Let me make sure everybody is actually... let me see. Let me just make sure for Barbarian. I don't know what you get at level 6. Let me see.
Do I take average?
Up to you. Either you want to do average or you want to do... roll for it. Just roll for it. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Just roll for it. So you take average then. So you get 7 HP. So your HP is at 69. Nice.
Nice.
Okay, so at level 6, you're going to get another Path of the Wild magic feature. So you harness the wild magic to bolster yourself as your companion's action. As an action, you can touch one creature, which can be yourself, and confer the following benefits to that creature. For 10 minutes, the creature can roll a d3. How the fuck are they supposed to do that in actual tabletop? Who usually has d3s laying around? You can roll a d3 whenever making an ability check or an attack roll and add the number to the d20 roll. Or you can roll a d3 and the creature regains one expended spell slot. The level of which equals the number rolled or lower of the creature's choice, basically. That's actually pretty fucking good. Why the hell do you get... That's such a random ass thing, man. Because you don't have spell slots, but... Let me go back to it.
I healed you by 11 wool.
Oh, thank you.
So yeah, once you do that, you can't do that again until like after a long rest, basically. So you can literally give Alora or Grizzly back a spell slot.
Cool.
based on the 1d3 that you roll. So if you roll a 3, you give them back a level 3 spell. If you roll a 2, a level 2 spell, or level 1 spell.
So I'm done, but I think they didn't apply the HP.
Yeah, you gotta do it yourself. That's a bug thing that Foundry does or whatever. So just click the cog wheel where it says configure hit points next underneath it and just change it to 69.
All right.
Yeah, I have yet to have Foundry do hit points right when you're leveling somebody up.
I don't know. I don't know why it's really fucking up. It's been that way since after they upgraded to version 10. Version 9 did it fine, but yeah, this one, I gotta change Zeno too. So, Zeno, you're at 77. Or 78.
You're at 78.
Yeah, 78. Oh, what the hell? Yeah, it bumps up the first one, but you're good now, so you got 51. I mean, you got 69.
No, I was gonna say, when I fixed it, it actually gave me more HP suddenly. Oh. Like I healed for more suddenly out of nowhere.
Gotcha.
I think I was at 44.
Yeah, bumped it up, yeah, with it, like, because it doesn't take it. So just subtract 7 from 51, and that's your HP.
Alright.
You guys take everything? Oh, yeah, it's just some copper. So the rest of the copper, I'm assuming, is going to go to everybody else, is that right? All the other,
Yeah.
Or is Wall taking, oh, no, Wall, I don't really, Wall
can no, take. I can't
call okay. So the rest of the copper is going to the rest of the group. They are going to take 94 pieces of gold. So there's nothing left in after all the treasure has been distributed. Who has the cloak of protection? That's Zeno, right?
Yep. Yeah, you got By the way, I fucked up. So my strength was based on the fact that 21 strength, but now that I'm back down to 16, I'm in comfort.
No, your thing lasts for 1 hour. You took the potion, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, you better figure something out in an hour.
if you ask really nice, breakfast will carry you.
Do you want? You can ask some of the NPCs to hold the gold for you, like trustworthy. I mean, they're all trustworthy.
Maybe yeah, I know.
It's not. Maybe Ella is kind of eh, but you know, if you want them to hold some for you, they can. Who do you want? You want breakfast to hold or somebody like that?
I assume breakfast would be the strongest one, so he probably hold the most, right?
He has an 18 strength.
All right, higher than mine.
How much gold do you want to give him?
Can I give him 3,000?
Yeah, he can hold 3,000. Let me see. He can't hold 3,000.
Okay, what about 2,000?
He can hold 2,000.
I'm going to push it, 2,500.
This price is right.
That is the edge. That's literally the edge.
Okay, I'll give him 2,500 gold to hold.
Okay. So he says, I'll give this to you, Buck. Let's see. But he says, that's going to cost you 10 gold pieces.
That's perfectly you know,
maybe,
fine.
Maybe we could give... Okay. Wait, I'm holding a lot of silver. I can trade it for the gold if you want.
I think you guys
are but 10 gold pieces is not a lot to lose.
Yeah, but basically we just need to get back. Like if I'm encumbered back in Fenland, I'll be fine because I just gotta walk to the
hopefully
change.
You know, no encounter comes up, so you know I gotta see I gotta roll two things, see if there's an encounter, and then see what type of encounter it is. Okay.
I was gonna say I don't know if it's just me. I could not find the tiger, feat or class feat for me.
Should have did it automatically.
So it gave me aspect of the beast, but doesn't specify as tiger, and I couldn't choose the two skills. So I guess I have to do that manually.
Give me a second. Let me see. I'll just make it. What does it do?
I'm gonna look it up again.
Aspect of the tiger.
Yeah, hold on. That's the wrong one.
Copy. No. Don't read it to me. Copy and paste it so I can put it in there. That's going to be too convoluted for me to write in there.
Oh, you want a cup? Okay, I see.
Yeah, I'm making it right now, so I put it in there. So.
Okay, give me a second. I was looking on my phone. Let me get that for you.
Y'all able to level up yourself?
Yeah, you can level up yourself.
Oh, okay.
So just go to features and then go to where it has your class, Sorcerer, and you change it to from 5 to 6.
Oh, cool.
Okay, let me post it.
And then when you level up, go ahead and roll for it, but you're going to take the average. And the average for a sorcerer is 4. But if you get higher than that, then you just take the highest, you take the higher one that you roll. So let's see what you get. Yeah, so you're just going to take the average. And you get, so your HP goes to 42.
Empowered healing.
Yeah, you get empowered healing. I don't know what that does.
Okay. If within 5 feet of you, they roll. Anyone can roll a dice to determine number of hit points a spell restores.
You gotta spend a sorcery point. Yeah.
To re-roll those. Oh, okay.
And you also get, since you're level 6, I'll let you level up first. I think you get like a level you get one more spell slot. I think. Another level 3 spell slot, so.
And a sorcery point. Wow.
Yep. Because the campaign ends when you guys are level 7, so you'll have one more level up.
Got it.
This one.
All right. Can I add a spell? Because I know 7 spells.
Yes, you're supposed to add one spell, so go ahead and add a spell.
Maybe counter spell would be useful.
Sure. You want counterspell? You can take counterspell.
I think that might be good for now. I wish I could get
more HP.
Better single target spell, but
I forgot about that.
So you're taking counterspell? There's a few other good level 3 ones up to you, but yeah, slow is good. Hypnotic pattern is good. Up to you.
Alrighty. I will take a look.
So just on Google, just go ahead and on Google, just type sorcerer spells, and then it'll tell you which ones that you can choose from the wiki dot, and choose like go to third level or whatever. RPG bot has a if you go to RPG bot sorcerer spells breakdown, they usually have them listed by tiers, usually like what's really good, what's not, and they generally have a really good recommendation list.
All right.
And here's the link for that. I want you guys, and it's completely up to you if you guys are kind of what type of character you want to play, but there is a recommendation. If you don't know what you want to, to choose from, what could be good. So I posted it in the chat for you. Okay, you gain 2 proficiency. Okay, so I'll do that right now and give you proficiency. And what did you choose?
Athletics and stealth, but I just did it manually because I saw you added the tire one. Because I did it already.
So your athletics and stealth. Okay, so you already added it. Good. Yep. All right, cool. Aurelia?
Okay. I think counterspell, but clairvoyance also looks cool because I can scout locations ahead within 1 mile.
You sure as hell could.
Let's see. What do y'all think? Would scouting be good, or the spelling magic, or counterspelling?
Well, counterspell is probably the best when it comes to facing other spellcasters. You can negate their spells. Right. Mm-hmm. But honestly, pick whatever you want. But if you think you have more fun with scout, go for it.
Whatever. I will say with clairvoyance, you are going to have to spend and get from like in town from Barthen a seeing eyeglass, and that costs 100 gold pieces. Because if you look, it has a component, basically, that it costs 100 gold. And you keep this, by the way. It's personally yours, but you just, you know, it's a spell component that you got to hold on to. But up to you.
All right. I think that would be pretty cool, the scout. But counterspell is also really useful, and I want to protect y'all. So I think I'll get counterspell at the end.
Okay.
Let's see. I think my hit points haven't gone up just yet.
Yeah, you gotta manually do it. You click on the cog. Oh yeah, you did. But yeah, you gotta click on the cogwheel next to max and change it to 44. And because it raised the other thing, it's gonna bump up to like 48/44. But you'll see, or 50, whatever. Yeah. So you're gonna change it back down. I don't know. It's a bug within Foundry. I don't know why it does that. Pretty stupid, if you ask me.
All right.
But let me see. What do you know? Else you get? So your thing. Let me see. I'm still trying to. So whenever you and an ally within 5 feet of you rolls dice to determine the number of hit points a spell restores, you can roll one sorcery point to reroll any number of dice once, provided you aren't incapacitated. I wish it said like you could take the highest or something like that, basically. But or add on an extra. You know, die, that would be pretty cool. I think Empowered Heroine is kind of eh. But it can, you know, if you roll a one on a hill die, you could always reroll it. So
it's just
like you're spending a sorcery point. I don't like that. I'm like, yeah, I have to do that just for a hit, just for a die. Ugh. Ugh. Sorcery points are precious, man, and that's not really worth it. But yeah, you do get another spell. So let me go ahead and put counterspell in your inventory.
All right. Thank
you. Let's see. Counterspell. Okay, counterspell is in your inventory. All right. Everybody good?
Yep. Oh, and just heads up, I gave myself 2 more hit points because I have tough.
Oh, you do have tough.
Yep, so it's 80. I changed it to 80.
Yeah, you do have tough. Oh my fucking god. Thank god we have a fucking totem barbarian and never went to explorers. Got fucking 260 something HP, hilt level 14. I'm like, how the fuck do I hit this guy? Oh my god, it's so ridiculous, man. With tough and that's insane. Oh my god. Okay, especially yeah. Your constitution was like high. Holy shit. Yeah, definitely for freaking Descended to Avernus. We're either doing point by or standard array. let me see. Okay, so it looks like you guys are all geared up and good. You guys are good? You ready to continue the story or?
Yep.
Yeah, it looks like I was just checking everything. I think we're good.
Yeah.
Like just curious, ritual casting. As long as I know the spell, yeah. I can spend the time to ritual cast without any extra feats, anything like that.
You should be able to. I don't see why not. Okay. Right? Yeah.
Like, I've always like, been confused about how ritual casting works because of 4th edition did things weird, and that's always kind of messed up my head. So.
Gotcha. Yeah, as long as you spend 10 minutes, you can just, you know, use it without spending a spell slot.
Okay.
Cool. Yeah.
As long as it's prepared.
Yeah, correct. As long as it's prepared, okay. That's it. Yeah, that's my only thing.
Cool.
And I think you have like a few things, right? That are that's ritual, like speak with animals. You know, that'll be kind of different though, because like let's say you're around a deer, deer may not wait 10 minutes for you to just you know.
Exactly. It, so, but the stuff like ceremony, detect magic, all that kind of
You're good for that. You don't need to detect magic because Well, unless Wall is incapacitated, yeah. He has that, so... which is funny. He has magic awareness, basically, so within 60 feet, provided he's not behind tunnel cover. He also can learn what school of magic it belongs to. It's part of his action. So, yeah, in that regard, I'm not sure what other ritual spells besides ceremony and purified drink and water or anything like that.
Detect poison and disease.
I think at some point, purified food and drink may be something. Yeah, I'm not saying I'm going to give you guys something poisonous or anything like that, but... you guys will be invited to certain dinners and stuff or whatever in the future. If you ever want to just lay that down there, and up to you.
Oh, Nahum, by the way, you might have to manually change your rages to 4 because I had to do that just now.
Let me check. Rages.
Yeah.
Yeah, you guys get 4 rages at level 6, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. I had to manually change it.
Yeah, I didn't change it to 4. Yeah, I'm surprised you didn't rage first, Wall, when you got up. When Zeno brought you up, you just ran up to Cosmot.
Yeah, I used a potion, remember?
Oh, that's right. Rage is a potion.
It wouldn't have mattered, honestly. Even with rage, you would have gone down, probably.
Well, I'm surprised he had the least amount of HP, and he just ran up to him.
Because Wall was like, no, you're not getting away. Like, Wall thinks he's just trying to run away. So Wolf's like trying to stop him.
Hey man, roleplay it. It is what it is. So okay, so if you guys are all ready, we'll go ahead
I'm gonna double check my spells known thing, but you keep going. I'll do that in the background. Okay.
Yeah. So all right, so everybody gets their gold, and you see everybody, smiles on their faces. They all look around and you see Dungeon. He's like, I guess we should report this back to Neverwinter, see what they need to do with the place. If we leave it here, I'm pretty sure it'll become like a bandit hut or something like that, so better leave it to the authorities, right?
Sounds like a good thing to me. Well,
I'll go ahead and see what I can do. Let them know, Well, what about Vin?
Careful
Vin,
with Vin. That Isaac guy. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. I'll keep talking about him. First time I really, heard of the dude, really. I mean, he did walk into Phandalin that one day, talking about you guys being heroes, stopping the dragon and stuff, but I don't really have much of an opinion about him. Just hearing a lot of hearsay, but we'll see what happens when we go back to Phandalin.
Yeah, let's just let Vin deal with it when he gets back and let him know.
Yep. Benvolio, what are you gonna plan to do? Benvolio looks, turns back. Well, in the meantime, me and Hubby are going to try to fix up this machine. You guys will need our help against the dragon, no?
That's correct.
Well then, we shall be allies, as you guys have helped me out. But, after that, we may be taking a very long trip somewhere else. Anyways, we'll see you guys later. And he goes to the machine and jumps or hops right in. And you start to see the machine start to move. And it exits out. What do you guys want to do? Head back to Phandalin?
I think so, with our pockets so full.
Indeed.
Yeah.
All right. So you guys head to Phandalin, and we're going to, everybody else is, everybody got their pockets full, and you guys successfully stopped the Hobgoblin raid. from occurring. Which, if, man, the events that would have played out that I had. So if Grizzly, Zeno, and Cypher went to jail, the Hobgoblins would have attacked Phandalin. Phandalin would have, like, you know, Allura, you wouldn't have been enough to stop it by yourself. Everybody would have, like, probably have moved to, what's it called? Axholm, which I already prepared as a backup, just in case. It would have been a completely different storyline. But that never happened. Because you saved Grizzly. And Grizzly made the option to,
well,
you know, barter. You know,
Grizzly's grit saved Grizzly, or yeah, his so honor.
Sure
in
did.
The end, I made changed things worse.
So that's what happened. That's how the story played out. So
was Grizzly really saved? I mean, really deep down.
I'll leave him to that to decide. All right, so you guys head back, and you guys are going to be able to take a, well, not a long rest yet, but you guys do head out into the woods, and you guys do meet back up with Valamin and tell him of the events that did transpire. He gets his share of the coin, you know, smiling, as a job well done, thinking he did all the work himself. And, yeah, I'll put you guys on the map as you guys are in the forest, getting ready to rest, with the aftermath. And let me know if you guys can see the map.
Got it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
All right, so you guys can see the map. Let's see. I don't know what's going to happen, but... All right, let me get rid of David Arkenstone. Let's play Valley in the Clouds. All right. So you guys are relaxing. You see Don John. He's like, see, I told you we were like those guys in the stories. Adventurous. Just wish we had Bing, you know? He's the only halfling I know that's in the story. Anyway, you, Zeno. Man, you could fight like your ass off, man. You were like, boom, pow, pow. What'd you learn to fight like that?
Well, let's just say I have experience in this type of work. Kind of brought that experience with me to Phandalin. It's carried me well so far. But, you know, Don, I just like fighting. I'm not really a killer. I like fighting, knocking someone out, and then fighting again later. It's all for fun.
Man. And you, Allura, you were like, fireballs just flying out. I was like, damn, look at that girl go. Where'd you learn that from?
Well, I have these guys to thank for all the extra fireballs. Definitely handy in a pinch, the staff that they gave me.
Hey, and you all, you ran up in there not thinking head first. I like it, though. You always put yourself before others. Got a lot of respect for that.
Thank you, Don John. Very kind words.
And man, every single one of you guys. Ella, you too. Jahira will be proud of you. You see Ella, she like crosses her arms and turns her head to the side and she's like,
Jahira this, Jahira that. Yes, yes, I know. She's the reason why I'm here. But I will say the gold was worth it. Anyways, there's a lot of things that we still have to do, Don John, and you know why we're here.
John John looks at her, oh yeah, 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 that's right. Still trying to figure stuff out. We're working on it. He turns over to Tia and he's like, man, Tia, you too, you were kind of good out there as well. Eldritch blasting and doing all this laser fire and stuff. Where'd you learn that from? You got a patron, don't you? She looks up at Don John and she's like,
I do, and well, let's just say I put a lot of stuff into who I call the Raven Queen.
Don John scratches his head. Raven Queen? I don't know nothing about that, but yeah. Tell her I'll buy her a drink next time. She nods and she looks over at Allura, Tia does, and she says,
Allura, where did you learn your abilities from?
Well, I think ever since I was young lass, they came to me innately, almost.
I see. Well then, a lot of us usually have to somewhat give something up, or at least learn magic. It must be quite nice to just know it automatically.
Perhaps in my lineage there was some power given by a divine being that helped me become like this. I'm very grateful for it.
Maybe.
I'd be able to use it to protect the village.
You see Valaman, he kind of walks up and he says, well, I'd say dealing with, a patron, we make deals, but like my patron's a quite hot individual, but nevertheless, she is someone who I give my dire allegiance to. You should try to choose one, Allura.
I'll take that into consideration.
You may get benefits. It may be a Cambion, it may be a succubus. You see Tia kind of look at him, and she kind of squints her eyes at him when he says this. And he says, nevertheless, a job well done is a job well done, guys. I commend you all for all my hard work. And at that, you guys got to see Ace and Cassandra sitting next to each other on the other side, smelling and sort of laughing at Valaman. Okay, so you guys see breakfast, and he says, "Well, the job isn't done yet. We still got to fight off the dragon. And besides, there's been those damn things that's been coming here lately. A lot of enemies and creatures. They just keep migrating here. Things I've never seen before. We still have that to worry about, besides the cult. There's something else going on, and I don't like it." And he kind of spits on the side. You see Ella, she's kind of puzzled as she is pondering a little bit. But Don John kind of lightens the moment up, and he says, "Well, in the meantime, I could tell y'all what... You know, the story about how I wrestled with a vampire." Everybody kind of just looks at themselves when he says this. And he does go on about a story during that. And let me see if something happens. Allura, roll a 1d4 for me, please. Okay. Where is everybody, right now? When you guys are taking... Who's taking watch firsthand?
Take watch. I don't need sleep, right?
Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming it's going to be you and Tia taking watch firsthand. Well, I guess Tia could take watch secondhand or whatever because she's an elf or whatever. Valaman too. And see. Grizzly, what are you doing right now? You're just sitting by everybody else?
Yep. Contemplating the pendant. As okay. Usual.
All right. Zeno and Wall, you guys probably should be knocked out, actually. You guys should get some sleep. Oh, shit. Forgot about you, Wall.
Mm-hmm.
An hour did pass by, and you are at exhaustion level 2. You start to feel your breath gets even heavier, and you start, coughing up some blood. No one has healed you yet.
Wait, oh, wait, wait.
He is diseased.
We got the scrolls.
Yeah. Wait, how much HP did I lose?
You didn't lose HP. You just take level 2 exhaustion.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's
if
already
you
applied.
Can't use a Malara, I can. So.
Wait, either I think Lesser Restoration would be the right one.
Yeah, Lesser Restoration would be.
Yep, that's why I bought those scrolls for.
All right, so you're casting it on him. So you cast Lesser Restoration on Wall. You're good. It doesn't matter. You're good. So you cast Lesser Restoration on Wall, and you know, you kind of start to see Wall, like, you start coughing up like some green energy, and it looks like all the stuff that was inside of your body starts to spill out, and it starts to dissipate into the air when she does cast this Lesser Restoration on you. And your bite wounds from the hobgoblins that bit you start to close up, and you feel rejuvenated. You are no longer diseased.
Woo.
Let's see.
Thank you.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. It must have been for when they bit me. I let my guard down.
Give me no problem. Second. So sorry I didn't do it sooner.
You do still have 2 levels of exhaustion, though. You're a little tired. Lesser Restoration doesn't get rid of exhaustion. That would be greater. So you are still tired. You're not diseased anymore, but you're still tired. And to get rid of, exhaustion, you do just have to take a long rest, and it gets rid of level, like, 1 level of exhaustion. So we're doing that in that particular order. But yeah, that's it right now. All right, so you guys, you guys get some, a good amount of sleep. On second watch, there's usually 3 watches. So second watch, well, Alora, you can just stay up if you want, if you just, you meditate. You do have to meditate for 4 hours, though. I'm not sure if you want to go into that state. At some point, you do have to meditate. You can't be, you can be surprised, but you're not unconscious, basically. So right. At what point do you want to, you're taking first watch, you and Tia, as you guys do meditate for 4 hours afterwards, I'm assuming. So who's taking second watch? Don John is knocked out.
Well, I'll take second since I've got dark vision. And
okay. So Cassandra and Ace are sleeping on each other, heads, not like hit together. Don John is out. Valamin is taking. Valamin will take second watch with you, Grizzly. Grizzly, give me a perception check. So, you start to notice that. You see, it looks like a reflection, and it's pointed at you, and you see a figure in black, and he's kind of waving at you, and you can somewhat realize that this person that's waving at you is the person who gave you the offer before to kill Isaac and some Neverwinter soldiers. What do you do?
Slip away to talk to him.
Okay, let me see if...
I can't find any conclusive stance on Shantia's stance on revenge.
Yep. So let me see... Let me see if Valamin notices. Valamin is not the most... He rolled a 6. Valamin doesn't... Valamin is literally like... He has a stick, and he's just like poking holes in the ground with it, spelling out his name. Okay, so you keep your distance from this guy as you're, I'm assuming this is what you do, right? You kind of, keep your distance from him.
I'm cautious.
You're very cautious of him. And we'll go to the map. The other side. And let me see if do you see the map?
Yeah, I see it.
Okay. So you see the individual there that gave you the offer, and he says to you,
I see that you have defeated the hobgoblins and the orcs.
Indeed. It seemed like it was necessary.
You also have not given your stance as we've been waiting somewhat at the waterfall. Do you still want that offer?
I'm afraid I can't agree to the deal.
Is it money? We could provide more if you need.
No, it's not about money. I think we're in agreement that Isaac needs to be stocked, but I need to find a way to do that my own way.
I see. It's very unfortunate that we could not come to an agreement. However, if you do decide to change your mind in the future, I'll see what our boss says. He may still give you the option for the agreement, but that is to be discussed. In the meantime, stay alive and stay well.
Indeed.
And at this moment, you kind of see that he kind of fades into the back, into the trees. You begin to hear some rocks from behind a tree over here. What do you do?
Does it sound like it would be from an animal or somebody else lurking?
Somebody else lurking.
You can come out of the shadows now. I know you're there.
You slowly see a slender body come out, and you see that it's Tia. She's looking at the ground, and she looks at you, and she says,
Grizzly, who was that?
That was someone from the Cult of the Dragon.
What? What did they want? And why were you talking to them?
They found me when I was wandering in the woods after leaving the prison. And they offered me a deal as a sick show of empathy, I guess you would call it.
You didn't take it, did you?
No.
They killed Beadric.
It is true that the people they've asked me to kill have also killed a lot of people that were important to me.
But two wrongs don't make a... Never mind.
No, you are correct. I turned them down.
She kind of like gives you a little half smile and she says,
I've been thinking, you don't think that they were the cause of what occurred today, do you?
I think they're another pawn.
Of who?
If not Isaac, then somebody who is pulling Isaac's strings. Or perhaps whoever's behind those half-orcs. You notice the anchorites of Talos were not in the camp.
That's true. Valaman did say that they did have a strange relationship as he did say, some of the Anchorites, they had bad blood with the orcs. And the hobgoblins.
Indeed.
And the dragon that's roaming around here. Do you think whatever that's doing this is the cause of this as well? Breakfast keeps talking about how stuff keeps appearing that's not even native to this land. Creatures and monsters. I don't know what to think anymore.
I can't speak to that. I've spent the last 2 weeks imprisoned.
I see. I still need to... I don't know, even if there was a cause for whatever it is that the dragon's here for, it still killed my brother and my sister. I don't think I can forgive that, regardless of whatever it was that caused it. I will kill that dragon.
That's understandable. And Tia, I owe you an apology.
Huh? What's that? For what?
Before we left and, well, events happened, kept me away, I didn't have a chance to tell you that it wasn't your fault. I think you needed to hear those words.
She kind of looks down and you start to see her grip her fists a little bit. And you see like a small tear come from her eye.
Thank you. I don't know if I can truly believe those words, but it's nice to know someone else thinks that I'm not at fault. It's not my fault.
I think if somebody told me that myself, I don't think I'd believe it.
Grizzly, why? What makes you fight for Phandalin?
I don't know anymore. I think for now it's... I have nowhere else to be.
This doesn't have to be your problem. You could just return back into the forest if you wanted to.
It's true. I'm tempted every day.
Besides, I keep seeing everyone get hurt. Cypher's gone. Pedrick. You or Zeno maybe next. Or Laura. I don't know what I would do if I would lose another one of you. We've only been here for around 3 months, but so far, you guys are the best family I have.
It's true. It's the first taste of family I've had as well.
Well, then, I'm glad you didn't accept that man's offer. I'm sorry, I heard you get up when you walked away, but I saw Valamin and I asked him where you were, and he kind of shrugged and probably said you were out taking a piss. But, Grizzly, just don't forget, everyone here still cares for you. I'm pretty sure if something were to happen to you, Krista, myself, Ella, Alora, Wall, perhaps, and Zeno's questionable, but I'm pretty sure they'll be sad. You're a good person. I've seen it.
I appreciate that. But sometimes being a good person isn't enough.
I could see. Well, I don't want to hurt you.
Oh. Get some. Let's finish second watch. We can talk more later.
Indeed.
And so you guys go back to the camp, and you do see Valamin as well, who looks back at you guys and sort of was wondering what happened, but he doesn't say much, and he kind of shrugs his shoulders, not really caring too much. And so you guys get some good sleep, and while everybody can take a long rest now, while you get back, you're at level 1 exhaustion.
Nice.
So I'm gonna put you back on there. So you still have disadvantage on ability checks, meaning initiative is a ability check. So you have disadvantage on your initiative rolls as well. When you do roll initiative.
It's fine, man. Let them all go before me. Save the best for last.
That's great. And so, yeah, everybody gets your long rest, and you guys prepare to head back to Phandalin. Let's see. So the morning comes, and you guys head back telling tales and stories as you guys all travel as a group. Almost like a fellowship. with all of you. Yeah, there's a lot of you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
I assume we attuned to our magical item now or no?
Yeah, you could. Yeah. Okay. Whatever magical item you picked up, attuned to it. Put the thing on, Zeno. You put the cloak on. You don't see the effects. Let me go ahead and fix that for you. Cloak protection.
I forgot we got removed for the food. +3.
Yeah. Everybody remove that +3 to your, that global bonus saving throw. No more food.
Well, I guess mine was already removed when we imported. So, okay.
Okay, yeah. I got something about that.
Yeah, I updated mine.
Let me see something. Let me put Zeno to 20 strength. God, dude, you have a +11 with athletics if you ever fucking... Oh my god.
So, we're removing the food buff?
Yeah, remove the food buff. It only lasts for a day.
Alright. That was a really good food description, by the way.
What was it? I forgot what I put. This is when I first started DMing, and I put like random stuff in. Like, this is back in like July last year. What did it say?
The list of the food.
Yeah, the list of the foods. Yeah. I was like just finding random stuff to put in there. Of like, what could it? Yeah, that took me a while. That was like, wait, you still got one more, right? Zeno? Or you, one that's
more.
It.
One more what?
And food.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I still have one more.
Okay, because it's actually supposed to be limited in the shop, and I think you bought all of you bought the rest of the comfort.
The comfort maybe. I bought two of them. Yeah, oh, I bought two, did. And then I think I bought like poor man's or something like a lesser like.
Yeah, so because they are supposed to expire from Toblin after a while. I changed it up. Give me a second. I'll do it later. All right. Let me fix your cloak of protection.
+1 AC, +1 saving throws.
Yeah, whatever that ring of protection. Let me see what the ring of protection. So +1 AC and saving throws. Change the DDB. Let's see. Dynamic effects. Effects. It's supposed to be a +1 effect. Why isn't it doing it? I don't know why it's not doing it. Let me see. So. Is it duration? No. Effects is on there. Super. Oh, that's why. Okay, so let's see. And your, let me see your saving throw. It should be a plus. Let's see. The fuck? I'm not seeing it. I'm going to change your global bonus to 2. You'll always have a static plus 2 to your global saving, your global bonus saving throws.
Oh, not plus 1?
No, because the Ring of Protection gives you a plus 1 to your saving throws as well.
Oh. And
it was doing it. It was already doing it, but
oh, okay.
But I had to change something in there too. Yeah, so armor class and yeah, so basically, okay, so you have a plus 2 to that. So you don't have a negative 1 to your charisma saving throw is. Alright, so you're good. You get a plus 2. Roll your strength saving throw. It should be a 10. Yeah, so it has the plus 2 at the end. Alright, you're good.
Yep.
And let me do the same thing to your AC. Let me fix that. I'll just like do this so it's supposed to do. There we go. So your AC is 19.
All right.
Yep, AC is 19 and you have that. Okay, so you're good. Anybody else equip a magic item that does something similar or no? I think everybody else is good then.
Yeah, like, I don't have to attune or anything to this trident, right?
No. I don't know. Does it say? Does it say attunement on it? It should say.
Let me double check. But
yeah, attunement is required. Attunement is required on it. But that's the only magic item that you have to attune to. So, you can just dominate beast. You can, yeah, cast dominate beast on it. Expend a charge from it. It has 3 charges. That's actually pretty good, actually. Yeah, I completely forgot. What the fuck? The DC's a 15. That's actually a pretty good try. I just read it now. What the fuck?
Oh, what, was I able to attune to it though while I was sleeping?
Yeah. You do it when you're sleeping, basically. So you're attuned to it, and you can cast Dominate Beast. Oh my god. So let me put the DC is put a flat. That's a wisdom saving throw, I think. Yeah, it's a wisdom saving throw. And it's going to be 15. So if you see like something like an owlbear or anything like that, like a beast creature, you could potentially cast Dominate Beast on it. It regains, it has 3 charges. I'll edit it later. Okay, so
Dominate Beast. So what does exactly do? Does it do?
You can control the beast. Tell it what you want it to do.
But for how long?
Until it like passes the wisdom saving throw, I guess. Let me see. Let me see. Dominate. It probably lasts for a good amount, actually, because like, so like, let me see. Dominate. Yeah, Dominate Beast is level 4 spell. So let me put it in your inventory. I put it in your inventory as a scroll. Put it back. Let me put it as an actual permanent spell that has 3 charges. So it's in your spell book. It has 3 charges on it. Okay, so it has 3 charges on it. And so Dominate Beast, you attempt to beguile a beast that you've seen within range. It must succeed a wisdom saving throw or be charmed by you for the duration. If you or creatures that are friendly or you are fighting it, it has advantage on the saving throw. While the beast is charmed, you have a telepathic link to it. As long as two of you are on the same plane of existence, you can use the telepathic link to issue commands to the beast, to the creature, while you are conscious. No actions required, which it does its best to obey. So you can run up and do things like attack that creature, run over there, fetch that object. If the creature completes the order and does not receive orders from you, it defends and preserves itself to the best of its ability. And you can use an action to take the total and precise control. You can use your full action to take precise and total control of the target until the end of your next turn. So the creature takes any actions you choose, and it doesn't do anything that you don't allow it to do. And during that, you can also cause a creature to use a reaction, but this requires you to use your own reaction as well, if it does have a reaction. Each time it takes damage, it has to make a new wisdom saving throw against the spell. If the saving throw succeeds, the spell ends. So yeah.
Not too shabby.
You have it up to, lasts for... Looks like it's 1 minute, since if you cast it with a fifth level spell slot, it's 10 minutes. So yeah, it's gonna last 1 minute. Yeah, it says 1 minute. Okay. So yeah, nice little nifty spell to have.
One other question. So since I leveled up and I learned Blistering Magic, it was talking about how many charges I have during a day.
You don't. Oh yeah, for not
based
not
on
you.
Proficiency.
One second. So your Blistering Magic,
Yeah, because I was like, yeah, I don't know what proficiency is.
Three. You don't know what proficiency is, and we've been playing for a full year.
Wait, what do you mean?
You don't know what your proficiency is, and we've been playing for a full year.
Yeah.
Look at your proficiency. It's at the top, next to your level.
Oh, there it is.
Hey,
I never
Sandy,
noticed that.
Sandy, you are so right, man. It's a good thing we don't play tabletop. Him, Brittany, and Philip, they'd be like, they don't know what the hell bonuses they're adding to their attack roll or anything, man. Like, holy shit. It's a good thing we don't play Pathfinder on tabletop or this, because I swear. Like, at this point, you don't know how to add your bonuses and stuff. We've been playing for a full year. Come on. All right, yeah, so. All right, so you could do it 3 times a day, basically. Yep. Okay, so you guys, why are you big? I don't know why you're so big. All right, so you guys return back to Phandalin. And so let's go back to Phandalin. So you guys return back after living it up, guys. And all right, so you guys return back to Phandalin, and you guys see, you know, some people looking at you guys. You guys see Libby. I mean, not Libby, you see Krista, she walks up and she talks to Valamin and looks like breakfast, and they give her a nod that everything went well. And you guys do see Vin out there. Vin has his arms crossed right now, and he's looking at these knights, these Neverwinter knights, in this direction over here. And it looks like Ander is talking to one of the Neverwinter knights, you know, he has like a smile on his face, and he's like telling them, it looks like he's like telling him something. You can't really tell what he is, but he just looks ecstatic seeing them and stuff. And you do see like his sister, Thistle, with her arms folded, just like shaking her head and sort of just like sighing at the sight. Donjon says, he kind of stretches. Oh man, it's been a while. What the hell are those knights doing here? Anyways, I'm gonna go get a drink. What you guys gonna do?
Yeah, I'm gonna head to the Miners Exchange, get this gold from the platinum. Zenon looks at breakfast and says, I'll be taking that back.
Oh!
Can we give Zeno everything?
Here you go. Take it. So you guys give Zeno everything and he just like waddles to the Miners Exchange.
let me add that back on. Oh, I'm gonna give breakfast 100 gold just for carrying it.
Yep. Hey, yeah. Thank you. Don't forget all the silver.
Oh, shit, you're right.
So you gave him...
I'll go with you. How about that? So that way you don't have to crawl on all fours.
I'll go too.
So go ahead and put that back. So, you gave him... Yeah, get your money back. You know, you get back 24... Yeah, you get back 2,400, right? Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, I already added it back. I'm in comfort. Okay. And when Zeno hears that they're both coming, he's like, God, I want to go by myself.
I'll leave you alone. I'll just help you carry it. Frankly, I don't want to go anywhere near the Stonehill Inn because I don't know what I would do with those knights around. So,
sure. Yeah.
Tells Zeno, it's okay, brother. You don't have to share the load on your own.
Uh huh.
All right, I'll give my stuff to Walden. If y'all don't mind walking encumbered to the Miners Exchange. I might hit up Marco because I want to learn more about how that dragon baby is doing.
Indeed. Like I said, you know, set something for that to happen. All right, so what's going on? So you guys
are going to move the currency from my inventory if you just want to factor it into the calculations.
Yeah, I just put it in the chat there.
Yeah. Great.
Yeah, so, I'm assuming Zeno's taking all of this, right?
Let's see how much I can carry more. let's see. Let me add.
You can take all of it. You're just encumbered, but you know, you're just, you know, what's his name's helping you too, Grizzly too, I'm assuming.
Yeah, I'll help.
As you guys waddle.
Okay. And then 950. Okay. Oh fuck! I'm almost there. I'm almost at a max limit.
Good, then I don't have to carry anything else. All right.
All right, then. We'll go ahead to the Miners Exchange. We'll meet you at the tavern if anything. Get a couple of drinks.
So, Walt, what are you doing?
I'm gonna go with him.
Oh, okay.
Because I got a bunch of copper on me.
All right, so give me a second. And Alora, you are going to be talking to Marco, right?
Yeah.
Oh, playing Opus actually. There's a few things you guys can do. A good amount of things you guys can do actually. So I don't know why that's not there, but whatever the case. So well. A second. Dragon of Iceberg Peak. Okay, So you three had to, give me a second. Let me just put it on the map. You three head to the Miners Exchange. You guys are there, right there. And I think you guys can see that map on the Miners Exchange, right?
Yep.
Yeah, yes. So you guys could just go there. Yeah, just go ahead and click on it, and you guys will have your characters there automatically. As you guys are there.
Zeno kind of knocks on the door before he enters.
Okay. This time he knocks. All right. So you do hear on the door, you hear a woman that says,
"Come on in, please. Ah, my favorite customer. Zeno, how are you?"
"Well, I'm doing good.
You have a friend today?"
"Yeah. We have a lot of, gold to carry that we want to exchange as some gems, and I couldn't carry all of it."
"I see. Sure, I can exchange it for you. Let me see.
I'll leave the sack for you right here."
"All right. Thank you, Grizzly. I appreciate it."
Yeah, you did kind of see her kind of eye you, Grizzly, as she did want to, say something, but, So she does look at you, Zeno, and she does say,
"Oh, it's a good thing he left, because I didn't want to do the exchange for free right in front of him there, you know?"
"Oh, not I understand."
"Well then, please, close the door. You can go to exchange. You need the platinum, right?"
"Correct."
"And sorry to interrupt. I'm a little confused. Where are we? Because I says all of us are at the bottom, but I'm not in a house."
Click the Fandle and Miners Exchange up at the top of your window.
Oh.
Yeah. You better hurry. There's a sock on the doorknob now.
So you do see Grizzly by himself.
Ball's rushing. "Wait, where's the building?"
He doesn't even know. You see Wall. He knocks on the door of somebody else's house, Grizzly. And you see.
"Wait, let me turn back. Grizzly, where's the Miners Exchange? I forgot
you
to ask."
You see the door opens up. "Hey, what are you doing?
Sir. I'm looking for the Miners Exchange. I went to the wrong place."
"The Miners Exchange, it's to the south across the street from here."
Oh, okay. Thank you very much. Sorry for the inconvenience."
"Yeah, no problem, man. Had another white-haired dude do the same thing to my cousin another time, anyway."
"Oh, there it is. Miners Exchange. Oh, it's right on this sign. I should have read this."
And so you begin to hear a knock on the door. I'm assuming you're knocking on the door. A wall. So you see a knock. He's knocking on the. So you hear a knock on, like, not the door, but the house itself, Zeno.
He looks at Holly. I was like, "Let me go check that out just to make sure there's nothing going on. I'll be right back." And then I'm going to open the door and see the wall. It's like, "Oh, what the hell are you doing here? I thought you were supposed to come here a while ago."
"I got lost a bit, still a little bit exhausted. I have more copper I need to give. I saw a Grizzly heading back, so I wanted to go and help you exchange them."
"Oh, you can just give it to me. I'll do it."
"All right then, buddy. Once you're done, I'll be at the bar. You can have a good drink and relax."
"Yep, sounds good. See ya."
"Take it easy."
Okay, so you guys gave all the money, I'm assuming, to Zeno, or how is it working right now?
Because
you guys,
yeah, I gave him all the money that I like all the all the silver pieces that I had.
Just only the silver pieces?
Yeah, because all the rest of my stuff's in platinum. We're all right.
How did you convert the gold to platinum?
I wasn't carrying any gold before.
Okay, gotcha.
So, yeah. So, I didn't pick up any of the gold.
Oh, you didn't?
Not from the chest at the orc camp, no. I just picked up the silver.
I picked it all up.
Oh, you picked it all up. Okay.
Yeah,
okay,
yeah. Gotcha. And then breakfast carried the gold. Some of the gold.
So I'll let you guys split the gold however you want to split it. It's up to you guys. I don't know if you guys want Zeno to hold it all or whatever. I'll leave that to you.
I'm giving Zeno 3,000 copper pieces, by the way.
All right. Put it in the chat. Make a note so that you know. Yeah. Put it in the chat. I'm talking about... put it in the chat in-game, though, home.
Yeah, I'm writing it there.
Okay. So 3,000 pieces are given to Zeno. Zeno has 45 right now.
Let me add that on then.
Okay.
And then 2,055 gold. Okay.
All right. So, you know, I don't know how you want to divvy it up. I'm not doing the math on this. I'll leave you guys to it. So, she exchanges it for you for free. So you can go ahead and click that that button if you want. That's going to put it all to platinum pieces. What you could do is you could take it out, however much Grizzly gave you. Take all the silver pieces out that Grizzly gave you. Take all the gold pieces out that you have. Put it in the chat. Take all the PP out and just see how much each person gets when converted, basically, one by one.
I was just going to split it three-way equally. So the 145, that's mine. I'm going to just take that out of the equation. But the rest of the platinum will be split three-way.
Is that what you guys want? If you guys want that, that's fine. I don't care.
Makes it easier.
Are you guys okay with that?
Yeah, I'll take my fair share.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right, so go ahead and so go ahead and do it. All right.
Okay. God damn, I lost so much weight. Okay, so 421 divide that by 3. It's a decimal. I'll just say everyone add 141 platinum. I'll put it in the chat for everybody. Yeah. Oh, actually, hold on. Sorry, I messed up on that one.
So 560. You had 145.
Divide that by 4. It'll be 100. I'm just gonna say 106. Everybody take 106 platinum.
Yeah, 106 platinum. That's correct.
Yep. So
just round up. It doesn't matter.
Yep. Everybody just add 106 platinum.
All right.
Yep. So you guys got 106 platinum.
And Alora. Okay, let me get rid of that then.
Insanely rich.
How much is 106 platinum? It's like 1,000. Yeah, you guys got, is that 1,600 or something like that? 1,060? Yeah, 1,060 gold, basically. Yeah, so I don't know how much platinum you guys have, but
you can see it.
Yeah, Zeno has like 2,000, basically 2,500 pieces of gold. Okay. That works.
Oh, and I gotta exchange the gems too. Let me just sell it to her. Sell those gems.
Yep, sell those gems. All right, so Grizzly and Wall, you guys head back to the town. I'm assuming like the main part of the town. What are you guys doing right now?
I was I don't know. I was kind of stopping short of the town square to give time for events to play out that may have happened while
you're just you're just lingering around. Yeah, so like
And Wall's at the bar.
You're at the bar. Okay. So you are at the bar and they are, you know, let me go ahead. So go back to the other map. Whoever's not there, whoever is there. In this meantime, two things are going to happen. So while you're settling stuff, Zeno, I'll let you settle whatever you need to settle. Let me know when you're done. But I'm going to roleplay Marco talking to Allura. And so you see Marco looks up at you, Allura, and he says,
"Oh, sis, you're back. How are you?"
"Marco, I'm doing wonderfully. How's everything at home with Mom?"
"Mom's been, I don't know, acting a little strange, but everything else has been good. I don't know, she's been really busy making potions, she says, for Neverwinter for some reason. Not sure why, but seems things are getting kind of dangerous."
"That's true. Have you noticed anything interesting with the cows at home?"
"Oh, but they still, like, act weird and stare, but they've been like that since, I would say, around a year ago."
"Yeah.
I don't know. They've been kind of awkward and stuff. But, oh, yeah. Our friend's getting better. You want to go take a look?"
"Sure. Yeah, let's go."
"Sure, let's go."
And he kind of looks over at Libby, and Libby starts whistling to herself. But you guys do head out to the cave entrance as well. And let me go ahead and activate the scene. And so, let me get a second. So you guys head back. And, you know, as you go back to the cave, which is, it takes around a good half day in order for you to, you know, get over there to where Marco is as he leads you with his youthful agility and excitement. And so, you know, he kind of dances around and you go back into the cave and he looks around and he says,
"Now, where is it? Where is he?"
And as you're walking around, looking around, you start to see a white face, a white dragon face appear, and it is flying around. It's small and just flying around, and you see Marco, and he's like, he says to you,
"Oh, there it is! Look! He's flying now!"
You can tell, like, the dragon actually looks a little bit happier this time around, as when it does, like, fly to you, it actually licks your cheek.
That's good.
As it's keeping itself in the air.
to befriend it.
Yeah,
a nice pet.
And so, you know, it does, like, give a gleeful growl. And, Marco says to you,
"See, he is getting better, Allura. I'm not really sure, but, you said you think that white dragon is his mother?"
I would bet it is the father, as you said it was a male, right? Maybe?
Oh, maybe, actually. I haven't really checked the genitals on that thing whenever it flies over us.
But Sol, I thought he said he saw an enormous dog.
he probably can't remember it. He did say that, actually. I forgot about that. He did say that. he does retcon-wise say he did see the massive dong on the thing. And you start to notice that he looks at it and the dragon starts like saying something, it looks like, to Marco. In a language you don't understand. And Marco looks at it and he shakes his head. And he also begins to speak in the same language.
"Marco, Don't want to interrupt you, but how can you talk to the dragon? Where'd you learn the language?
He looks over to you and he says,
I'm not really sure, but lately I've been able to pick up languages from different races. It seems like somehow I'm able to just simply pick it up.
Oh, it's a very rare skill you have.
When Mom was talking to that elf woman, they were talking in Elvish, but then they switched to a different language, and I seemed to pick it up as well.
I see.
It was like something like Sylvan or something, like as Mom has stated, but I don't know how I've been able to just simply understand different languages.
Might be one of your special skills that you have. Maybe we could use it in the future if you decide to go traveling. I think it bodes well for you being a great adventurer.
He begins to scratch his nose and he says,
well, hopefully I could become a great adventurer like you. Anyways.
Oh. You guys are talking, you're kind of cut off as you start to see the dragon. It shifts and looks towards the entrance and it starts to growl. What do you do?
Uh-oh. You're like, get behind me, Marco. And I kind of get myself in between the dragon.
It looks like you see a shadow of a person by the entrance of the cave.
Like, who's there?
And when you say that, you begin to see bright red hair as it's Libby.
Okay, it's Libby.
Libby, she shifts her head out and she says,
oh, wow, looks like it's gotten bigger. Marco, this is what it looks like? I knew it was here, but I didn't actually see it myself. You've been hiding out on me. And Alora, it looks like it's nice to you too. Marco said it was angry before.
Yeah, it must have been just scared or confused, maybe. I think it really helps that Marco can talk to it.
Libby!
It's not in danger.
You're not supposed to be here, Libby! You gotta keep your mouth shut on this one! Don't worry, Marco! I can keep that pucker of mine shut! I think. Alora, trust me, right,
your pocket.
Let's just say, for a gold coin, I'll do just that. Ain't that right, Alora?
All right, I'll give you two.
My lips are sealed.
All right.
Well then.
Yes.
You know, Marco, us girls gotta keep secrets together. You can trust us. I guess so. But, Alora, do you think we should tell Grizzly, Wall, and Zeno about this? They may try to kill him.
You know, I think they'd be rather understanding. I think they've really turned over a new leaf besides Zeno.
Actually, on second thought, can we just keep it between us? I don't want them to know yet.
Right. But if ever the Daddy Dragon comes around, I wonder what will happen. Might be better for them to know closer to that time. So our friend here doesn't get caught up in the confusion. We could possibly resolve everything peacefully. Well,
I think so as well, but we'll see when that time comes. In the meantime, do you know what happened to Cypher? Looks like he's back and nobody said anything about him yet.
I think Grizz informed us of what happened. Did you? I think you did.
Huh? I didn't hear
anything. I was a little blunt about it, yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah. And unfortunately, it seems our actions may have gotten Cypher. Well, he's no longer with us.
What?
I'm so sorry, Marco.
What do you mean?
He kind of takes a step back.
Some mercenaries were going after Grizz, and Cypher had some history with them, it seems, and I tried to save Grizz as he was the only one up and about, and everyone else was unconscious, so the mercenary leader grew angry and finished off Cypher, unfortunately. I feel as though I'm somewhat responsible.
He begins to look down, and he shakes his head, and he says,
"No way! No way Cypher went down like that! You're lying!"
Well, I wish I were, but there were so many mercenaries around us, and fortunately it was a very difficult situation.
You see Libby, she kind of walks up to him and puts her hand on his shoulder, and she says,
I think they're telling the truth, Marco. Auntie Krista was talking to some weird guy, and they did say Cypher passed away.
He looks up at her with an angry look, and he says,
"What? You knew?"
She looks down and she says,
"I'm sorry, Marco. I thought it would be best if Laura told you." "You knew and you didn't say anything?"
At this point, Alora, it looks like he's about to run out of the cave. Do you do anything?
I'll go up to him and give him a hug, maybe.
He tries to avoid you. Do you want to try to forcefully grab him?
I'll take his hand with mine and be like, "Marco." All right.
This is going to be like, you know, you're kind of getting agile with it. So you're going to have to give me an acrobatics or dex, whatever your favor for acrobatics or dex. Obviously, acrobatics will probably have the highest for you, but yeah. I don't think he can, let's see. So he tries to nimbly dodge you. Shit! Somehow
damn,
he just like
really pissed.
Somehow he just nimbly like dodges like to the side of you, and he dashes out from the cave, shaking his head as he runs out.
Well, maybe it's best if he has some time to think about it.
The dragon looks at over and follows him as well.
Never mind.
Come on,
Libby, let's go.
Libby looks like she looks completely confused as she runs out. And you see Libby as she says, like, she starts to say to herself,
"I am not built for this."
She runs out. So you guys run out of the cave, and time passes by, and the camera then shifts towards Zeno. And give me a second. Let's go back to Zeno. So Zeno, you're with Halia right now, and she says to you,
"I'm assuming you would like some more tea again, Zeno, for your courageous efforts.
Well,
please join me."
"Of course."
"Well then, what exactly happened with the Hobgoblin encampment? Is everything all right?"
Everything went well for the most part. We stopped the hobgoblins and it works. Though, I don't know how to put it, but it seems that there's some scheming and some plans going on beside us.
I see. What do you mean by that?
Well, I'm not entirely too sure, but it seems like the orc encampment was a setup.
Interesting to note. Do you think that the cult is behind this?
It could be. I'm not entirely too sure.
Well then, you do have to be careful. Here, in times like this, we have to simply depend on one another.
She pours you a nice cup of tea. What are you doing right now?
Well, Zenon kind of just sips the tea.
And it does taste like green tea. It's like a nice, you know, barley flavor.
Okay. It's really good tea. And says, Zenon says, what about you? Have you learned anything new?
I have not learned anything new. However, there is something that I want to ask you. You said, you guys came back recently from that place. Was there anything weird that you saw about War? Did he act weird to you?
No, not really. He's still himself. He's my barbarian brother.
Some people say I keep hearing reports about him. He's not to be trusted, but nevertheless, be careful around him, Zeno.
Of course. I appreciate your concern.
Absolutely. Would you like to stay a little bit longer?
I thought you never asked.
And so the screen turns black. And we do have, at this point right now,
we just hear Careless Whisper playing.
Oh, God. Okay, so, Grizzly, you know, night is about to fall down. Same with Alora, as you're about to chase Marco into the woods. The Stonehill Inn, so you're going back. Oh, yeah, like, Wall, you went back to the Stonehill Inn. So we got to go back to that, actually. You went inside the bar.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so you're at the bar. Laura is technically not here with Marco and Libby. So I'll just give you a stream or whatever. So you... second. Where are you? You're down there. Wait, where the hell are you, actually? Did I not put you on the map? Oh, yeah, you're at the bar. Yeah, you walked into the bar. Give me a second. So you walk into the bar, and you notice that no one is in the bar except for, like, one random person. None of the Neverwinter Nights are in the bar. You do see this woman, by the way. And as you look at this woman, she has white hair, straight white hair. And you could tell that, you know, she looks to be, like, in her young 30s. She's wearing plate mail that looks like it's from Neverwinter. And she kind of looks at you as she, you know, she has a mug in her hand. And this is what she looks like. And she slams the mug down a bit or whatever while drinking. And she says to Toblin,
thank you, Toblin. I appreciate the help.
Toblin nods and he says, anytime, hey, I think he may know too. He looks at you and he says,
Hey, Wall, you know anything about that slot activity, right? So you weren't there. So you don't know what the hell he's talking about. What do you say? Are you on mute, Nahum?
Oh, sorry.
You're not talking. Yeah.
There we go.
Yeah, okay. Cool.
So I just focus my own business and I say, I'll just have a dragon's ale again.
No. He said to you, do you know anything about the slot activity? Do you answer him? I said your character wasn't there.
No, that's what I'm saying. No, that's what I'm focusing on my own business. I'm just going to go to Dragon's Ale.
Correct, but you didn't answer him yes or no. So that's what I'm saying. Like, you just immediately tell him, just give me
a...
Okay,
I'm not sure.
Okay, but, so
can I have a Dragon's Breath Ale?
Yeah, so he looks over and he pours you one and give me a second. Let me bring something out. Where is and so there we go. Okay, so you see the woman as you know, he's pouring the drink for you. And she looks over at you and she says,
"You are a warrior, are you not?"
Yes, I am.
How long have you been in Phandalin? Quite some time?
Not very long. Been a little over a week.
I see. Well then, are you friends with Ven?
Ven, Name sounds familiar. I know of him, though I don't know him very well.
Well then, let's just say there's been a little bit of activity that I've been hearing about some slots. You could call me Daria. Nice to meet you.
Daria. My name is Wol. You said it was slots?
Their entity is not from this plane. They look like frogs. They're called slots. Me and some of the knights are going to go take care of them, along with Ven. It seems as though that you went there.
I see. Well, I wish you luck. There have been lots of trouble around these parts. I'm here helping out this town currently with their troubles.
Another thing. Have you seen a man that goes by the name of Isaac?
And when Wall hears this name, he gets kind of irritated, like his eyes, like, what's his last name?
Isaac Hawkins. He's part of Neverwinter.
Wall doesn't really know what to say, except just to say, what about him?
Why are you saying it with such a tone? I'm simply asking if you've seen him or not. He was supposed to be
in Phandalin recently.
Ah. A few days ago, I assume. He must be at the fort.
That's correct.
Well then, I'll check to see if he's at Guthor's fort then. I appreciate your help on asking me about if he was here or not. You said Wall was your name.
Yes. Forgive my tone. I'm simply exhausted. You said your name was Clara, right?
It was Daria.
Daria. Please, let me buy you a drink. You must be tired from your journey as well.
Well, I'm originally from Coneyberry, but now I simply work under Dacko Doverimba. And Neverwinter. But I appreciate the drink, though.
It's no problem. I'm sure you have a lot of work on your shoulders.
It's just nothing that I fear.
When you look into your eyes, you do see, like, yeah, they're bright yellow. Like, you've never seen people with eyes like this before.
And Wall just sort of just keeps that in the back of his mind, like, that's interesting.
She does smile, and she takes it, and she drinks the ale. Do you drink it, too?
Yes.
Go ahead and give me a constitution check. Kind of get a little, you know, tipsy off the first drink, and she says to you,
"Would you mind buying me another?"
Sure. It'd be my pleasure.
Or how about this? I'll buy you one. And myself as well.
Really, it's very kind of you, but I insist I'll buy for you again. It's my good deed for the day.
She smiles and she says,
"Trust me, this is my 10th drink."
Well, I think you can definitely hold your ale better than I.
Presumably. I'm just getting ready to head out. And I do need to be on the edge, and this allows me to do so. It sounds silly, but let's just say this is the only thing that quenches my thirst.
Paul has no idea what she's talking about, but he just says, "Well, as long as you're able to do what you need, that's all that matters."
She smiles and bows to you. And she says,
"I'll leave this extra one for you, though. Good luck, Wall."
"Well, I appreciate it, and I'm going to drink that one, too."
And she heads out. We're going to say to Toblin?
So I say Toblin. She was pretty nice.
He looks over at you and he says, "You don't know who that is, do you? That's Daria."
"She introduced you." "Yeah, Daria.
Daria the Executioner."
"Uh-huh."
You're serious right now? Well, she's known as the Executioner of Neverwinter."
"Well, there's all sorts of jobs out there. Although I do prefer to keep life, sometimes you're forced to take it."
"Well, then, she mainly executes the criminals and stuff, but I don't know, man. Having that type of job, you know, word gets around. Apparently everyone in Neverwinter sucked in doing so, but she was the only one to cleanly slice off people's heads when it needed to be sliced off correctly and accurately. It's almost knows, like, they know, there's rumors that she knows every part of anatomy there is. The body parts, when to pinpoint them."
"I see. If anything, perhaps that means she is qualified for the job. After all, the people won't suffer. They'll be quick and clean. Unlike also, with other methods."
"You saw her eyes, right?"
"Yes, they were golden or yellow. Never seen that before.
I'm not sure, man. It freaked me out, but, well, if anything, I'm kind of glad she's gone, because a lot of people exited the bar, but she was nice, but her demeanor, everything, just kind of made me feel, I don't know, scared a bit.
Come now, Toblin. Can't just judge a book by its cover. No matter what they look like, or how it may seem, you have to look at their actions. She was a very kind person.
Yeah, she was. And
he says, he like starts looking around and he sees that she's still outside. And it looks like she is talking to, she walks up to Andrew and she looks like, I don't think anybody's around. Grizzly, you're keeping your distance from these people, right? You're not even close to them.
Yeah, I'm trying to surreptitiously keep my distance.
Okay.
Don't want to be noticed by them.
Yep. And so she looks like she says something to Andrew, and Andrew kind of bows to her and like gleefully talks to her, and she looks like she's having a cheerful conversation with him, and then she like puts her hand on his like shoulder, and she starts to rally some of the knights, and she looks at Vin, and Vin has his arms crossed, and he also starts to travel south with the Neverwinter Knights as well, as they begin to head towards where it was reported that the Slad was at, that you have no clue what's going on. So yeah, they head south, and they don't seem to, you know, she kind of like looks your way, but she doesn't say anything to you, and they don't say anything, and they kind of just like tread south. And that's it. And so I'm guessing you're heading to the bar now?
Yeah.
All right. You kind of see Andrew, and he starts walking up and talking to Thistle. It looks like about like becoming a knight of Neverwinter. And she kind of just like groans a little bit, rolls her eyes, and starts heading back to Barthen's goods. And he follows along with her. So you enter the bar and you see Wall sitting by himself next to Toblin. Anything you wanted to say or do?
Oh, Grizzly. Welcome. Come up and have a drink.
I think I'll pass. But who was that knight that was here?
Oh, she was a very kind person. Name is Daria. Actually even bought me an ale after I was already drinking.
So that's Daria.
Oh, you know of her too?
In passing. It had to do with a job offer recently. But now I have a face to the name.
Well, I heard she's an executioner of Neverwinter, but she seems incredibly kind.
I think that may be the drink talking, but I'm glad you think so.
Well, if we go by her actions, she's probably one of the nicest people I've met. Like I told Toblin, can't judge a book by its cover.
I see.
So at this time, you know, you're just chilling in the bar. It is about to become night. And I'm assuming, so there is an upstairs that I added to this room. The downstairs rooms are preoccupied. Grizzly, you normally just sleep outside, right? You're not staying inside of the
inn. No, I've been staying in the inn lately.
Oh, you have? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so good to know. So today, are you going to sleep in the inn or sleep outside?
Yeah, I'll sleep in the inn.
Okay. Wall, you're gonna sleep in the inn?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and Zeno, you sleeping in the inn?
Yep.
Okay, so the three of you are sleeping in the inn, and during this time, Alora is chasing after Marco in the woods. And you guys are getting, you know, getting some notable sleep. Zeno, give me a constitution saving throw. All right. Solid. We will continue off next after we take a break. We're going to end at like 6 today, so let's just take a 15-minute break, and we'll come back.
All right.
Also, all right, I added a sound to the soundboard. Let me go to
What sound was it? Zeno, oh man.
Nice. Now I know what to play. Next
I've been
time.
Feeling. This is Krista. Yeah, I'm not gonna be your DM to narrate such stuff. The screen just goes black. This is not Baldur's Gate 3.
I'm okay with that.
Baldur's Gate 3. And I'm like, oh, what the fuck? As we all, like me, Tristan, Carlos, staring at Chris's scene, like freaking like Mike from Monsters Inc., like that meme. As we just watch a scene, we just watch a scene of him like having sex with Lizelle or whatever. We're like, yeah, I'm not watching this. Chris was like, that was the only person who wanted to have sex with me. I'm like, yeah. He's like, well, unless it's like Housing or Will or Gail, thirsty dudes. All right, so I'll see you guys in 15 minutes.
All right.
All right.
All right.